Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Tuesday, August 11th, 2015. We have a huge show today. Alex is coming up in the next segment. He'll be here live to talk to astronaut Story Musgrave. He'll be joining us in the second hour. He'll also be interviewing with a live update our reporters Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs, who are now in Ferguson. And it's interesting that the Ferguson story has now taken on a different tone. It's no longer predominantly about what's happening between provocateurs within the demonstrators, provocateurs on the police side. No, it's now become, in the media, about the oath keepers, people who are there trying to keep the peace, people who are there protecting businesses, black and white. And of course, Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs got to know some of the oath keepers, covered that, covered what they were doing when they were there a year ago. And so as they got together, that became the story. CBS is now spreading a rumor that we hired oath keepers to protect InfoWars. Absolutely false. So Alex is working on a big story. He'll be here shortly. But let's go to the anniversary report, special report that Joe Biggs and Jakari Jackson filed about Ferguson. Here we go.
Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs reporting for InfoWars.com. As you guys may recall, we've documented quite extensively the activities that have been going on in Ferguson, Missouri since last year we had the incident that happened with Michael Brown. And to get you guys up to speed, Michael Brown was shot after an interaction with an officer. Some people say it was justified, some people say it's not. With all the information, you can make your own decisions now. But since that time, we've had multiple actions by the police and also by the people in the crowd that just were pretty sensational, to say the least, Joe. We've had riots, tear gas, people threatening to burn down the police station, attacks on the police station. So there's plenty of blame on both sides, but that can't include any and everybody. You know, there are plenty of good protesters out there, and there are plenty of good police officers who just want to keep the streets safe, but you also have a good mixture, more than a few, of bad apples in both sides of the bunch. So we've been out there in this past August, we were out there this past November, and now we have a new incident that's going to send us out in just a few hours. Joe?
Ferguson 3.0. Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs, we will be on our way there in the next few hours. And what we know, last night was the one-year anniversary of Michael Brown being killed by Officer Darren Wilson. Now, like you said, whether you think it's a justified action or not, we're just here to cover what's going on. And right now, the facts are there are people out protesting, peaceful protests throughout the day, largely late at night. A lot of people left. There was about 100 people left in the crowd. They had undercover police officers dressed in civilian attire walking around, and they spotted people with guns. So those guys were kind of keeping an eye on that. Later in the night, it broke off into basically a gun battle for about a minute long. They said that the firefight was going on for about a minute straight. Rounds were coming in towards the police officers, and they spotted a suspect running away from that area, and that was 18-year-old Tyrone Harris Jr., who the police confirmed that he was one of the armed suspects firing into the crowds and towards the police officer. And we also now know that he is a friend, or was a friend, of Michael Brown. And now we have a new article up at Fox News saying that there's a state of emergency issued for the St. Louis, Missouri area. So protests have put the Ferguson back on edge. There's been another shooting, so we're going to go out there and document what's going on so you, the American public, can be informed about what's happening in Ferguson. I'm Joe Biggs.
Jakari Jackson. Keep up with all of our reports on the Alex Jones Channel on YouTube.
And again, we're going to have a live update from Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs in Ferguson. That's going to be in the third hour. In the second hour, Alex is going to be talking to legendary astronaut Story Musgrave. Alex will be right back. When we come back from the break, we're going to have a special report from Alex. Total emergency alert. Elite are now evacuating. And certainly you can see the push and the unrest that may follow through the rest of the country if the Southern Poverty Law Center and George Soros have their way as they are in Ferguson. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Jones here with a emergency alert message. It is Saturday, June 20th, 2015. And before shooting this special report, I spent hours in research and contemplation. And I want to just be clear. You need to listen extremely carefully to what I'm saying, so that this message is not lost in the haze of the cacophony of other voices and factoids out there. And the reason I say that is not in some lecturing, condescending way. It's because it hit me this morning when I was out with my children having fun at the Greenbelt that even though I'm close to this information and research constantly, that the mere fact that so much is happening in our world, I had gotten to the point where I wasn't clearly recognizing the writing on the wall for what it is. And I'm about to get to that information in a moment. And what helped spur me further to that was not one, but two different calls today by extremely prominent wealthy people who were asking me, why aren't you leaving the United States before October? Thinking that I'm super in the know and have all this inside knowledge, which I do to a certain extent. And to both individuals who don't even know each other, I said, what are you getting at? And they said, what are we getting at? You talk about it every day. And again, I'll cover that in a moment. And they proceeded to tell me about all the other people they know with high-level inside connections and military connections that are getting out of the United States. Now, I told this story 5 years ago. It's now 5 years later. That I was setting up a trust, family trust, at the most prestigious law firm probably in Austin, Texas, downtown. And I ran into a very attractive middle-aged lady who told me who she was. I didn't know who she was. And told me that I was going to get very big and successful and that she was preparing to leave the United States and that other elites were already leaving to New Zealand and other areas. And then I talked to some Hollywood folks and they knew about James Cameron planning to leave the United States. And then later that ended up happening. So the point is, for all these years, I've been hearing about this. And then it comes out in London Guardian about the elites running to New Zealand and the Cook Islands and Luxembourg and all the billionaires leaving Israel and in the last few years, all of them. And it just started mounting. And now we see what they're running from, what they've been told. And so I've been so close to it that you wait for this stuff to basically happen forever. You work as hard as you can to stop it from happening. But then you enter a territory where I'd say there's about a 50, 60% chance we're going to have a major war with Russia. There's going to be a total worldwide financial meltdown and basically World War III. And by the way, it's all these top analysts now saying it, and George Soros and everybody else. We were saying it was a danger at first because of our sources, but halfway hoping we were wrong, or halfway, you know, trying to convince ourselves it wasn't true, because who wants to believe this stuff? I'm not happy about being vindicated. But you get so close to a problem, when you're an expert, you then kind of get blind in a way, is what I'm getting at. Now, with that preface said, here's what I'm breaking down. I'm not here to scare you. Having awareness of this, having a group awakening, group consciousness tremor over this information can stop it from happening. And we'll be ridiculed if it doesn't happen, and they'll say, why didn't it happen when humanity stopped it? That doesn't matter. What's important is that we do engage in alarmist activity because we're in alarming times. World financial meltdown. We're about to break that down. Major military conflagrations and escalations. Elites running to the hills and to their bunkers at an accelerated rate. All of this happening, and now Europe began to plunge into the biggest financial crisis since the 1920s and 30s this week, and it's barely in U.S. news, and it gets worse. And it was hiding in plain view. The one person I talked to is huge in entertainment. The other is in banking and military. And they were all saying the same thing. They said, Alex, are you seeing what's happening? Central banks are having runs on them by governments for gold. And again, it's speeding up to a crescendo. Elites are hoarding cash while top bankers are coming out saying ban cash for the public. That's been all over the news. Ron Paul says the day of reckoning is about to hit. Everybody's got this bad feeling. We don't want World War I to happen. We didn't want World War II to happen. They happened. We have one now. It could be the end of life on this planet. Let's get into the news, and I'll give you my final conclusion. Look right here. Voice of America yesterday. Greeks turn to cash as bank crisis looms. What is the bank crisis? They're preparing a bail-in where they take part of your bank account and give it to private banks. It's not even your personal debt. It's global derivatives debt the government signed on to. The bank's debt. Zero Hedge, links to London Guardian, you name it. What do they know? Why are so many of the super wealthy preparing bug-out locations? From the Ozarks to you name it. Here's CNBC. Ron Paul, stock market, day of reckoning is near. Okay? Let's continue. It's time to hold physical cash, says one of Britain's most senior fund managers. There's a pile of gold in Manhattan. This happened just Friday. There's a pile of gold in Manhattan. This is all this week. Texas wants it back. Texas is pulling its gold out of the private Federal Reserve. And Jade Helms coming up. They know which states aren't going to go along, which state leaderships won't go along with martial law. I thought Jade Helms was just a drill at first. I didn't know why they freaked out so bad ahead of time. It's the cover for military occupation of the Southwest. And I've been told that by high-level military now. And we found all the documents and did a special report, Jade Helm Mystery Solved, this last week that's gone viral, where we had all the documents where it's about rounding up the public and controlling the media. I can't even believe it's actually happening. I mean, we're on the edge, folks. I mean, people are asking me, why aren't you leaving the country? I mean, it's now gotten to an evacuation point. You know, like when Krypton's blowing up. I mean, Nazi Germany's taking over. There's a pile of gold in Manhattan. Texas wants it back. Texas is taking it back. China reveals what's behind its golden curtain as they pull their gold out of the U.S. Where's Germany's gold? Germany's trying to get its gold back, and the U.S. isn't giving it back to them because it's really gold-plated tungsten. I heard that 15 years ago from insiders. Now it's all come out. And I was also told by insiders 35 years ago when I was like 6-7 years old, and then 20 years ago, and over again by all the insiders, they said all we've been told by high level is when you see rainbow or the colored money come out, that's when they're getting ready to plunge the economy and bring in the global cashless society. And I was hearing this from FBI agents, Dallas cops, insiders when I was 6 years old. There's a reason I've been here warning. And I mean, I'm sitting around the coffee table while my dad's drinking beer, you know, with FBI people and John Birchers and stuff, hearing all this. And now the money's coming out all rainbow colored. I mean, and I'm like, whoa, this is all happening, and I'm not even freaked out. Everything we've heard that was going to come is now here. U.S. troops fighting Russians in Ukraine. I mean, our government funding radical Islam to attack Christians and kill them. I mean, it's just craziness is taking place. Where is Germany's gold? Germany wants their gold. Russia wants their gold. They all want their gold. And people are bugging out en masse. And here's my final point. When I talked to these folks, they said other billionaires and people worth hundreds of millions of dollars and insiders are leaving. And it's basically reached panic point now. You know, James Cameron left 4 years ago. Other Hollywood. So we already have evidence that we're a 50-60% chance that there's going to be a global financial meltdown. Every expert we talk to says it's coming. Mainline news says it's coming. I don't know. Bubbles could go on for longer. But we need cooler heads to prevail. We don't want war with Russia. We don't want to destabilize the Middle East. The chutzpah, the arrogance, the bravado of the elite needs to stop right now. The military is in the stars and stripes training to take on veterans and gun owners. We've got IBM computers, you know, deciding which troops get medical care and who doesn't. I mean, we're living in a dystopia already. But the old, free, wealthy society is still there partially. They're running in parallel, but the evil is absorbing the good. This is a detailed report. I'll be breaking it down more tomorrow with a Sunday show, 4 to 6 p.m. Please tell your friends and family to tune in. Tell me what you think in the comments below at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com, and we'll also post this to YouTube and a Facebook video. But folks have got a reason to be upset and concerned. Oh, and the government has been caught, and George Soros trying to foment race war in the country with all these bizarre incidences. I mean, you add all this together, it is dire. It is dire. I hope we can get the word out. I hope you get the word out. I hope that cooler heads prevail. I hope this is de-escalated. But the bank runs have already started in Europe. They're already talking about taking control of your after-tax money to bail out governments. I mean, this is a total commitment by the elite to implode the world system and bring in their world government. The Pope's calling for a planetary government to have carbon taxes. All the globalists are coming out of the closet right now. They're making their move. This is their blitzkrieg. This is the launch. It's basically already begun. The war has already begun against humanity. The New World Order takeover is here. It's here. The New World Order is here. I'm just trying to think of the words to describe to you. It's all happening. They got senators calling for microchips when people get arrested to be put in their bodies. CBS News. I mean, it's just everything starting to happen, and it's just the beginning. It's like going over the edge on a roller coaster. And now we've got to the top, and we're starting to go down the plunge. So strap yourselves in. Alex Jones here, just trying to see what you think.
Hopefully. And again, that's Alex Jones' special report, Total Emergency Alert. It's had millions of views, and we wanted to get that out to you because now we see a massive fulfillment of what we've been concerned about. People, headlines. Ferguson protesters so can't. We're ready for war. We'll be right back. I'm David Knight, but Alex Jones is going to be here very shortly. He is working on a very important story. He's going to be interviewing as well in the next hour, astronaut Story Musgrave. In the third hour, he'll be talking to our reporters who are live in Ferguson, Missouri, Joe Biggs, Jakari Jackson, and of course, that has erupted on the one-year anniversary of the happenings there in Ferguson. Just take a look at this story that's up on Infowars.com. The U.S. economy continues its collapse. Remember what Gerald Celente says? When people lose everything, they lose it. This is what we're seeing happening now in Ferguson. Here's some of the headlines. New York Times, emergency declared in Ferguson after shooting. Fourth night of Ferguson protests brings confrontation and arrests. Ferguson protesters chant, "We're ready for war." Black Lives Matter mob shuts down I-70 both ways in St. Louis, but a driver plows through the line. That's a video. These are just some of the national headlines, but now they are focusing on the Oath Keepers and on InfoWars. It's not the provocateurs and the protesters. It's not the provocateurs and law enforcement. No, it's InfoWars. We're told that InfoWars is and Oath Keepers are the problem. We've got local law enforcement talking about how the Oath Keepers need to be taken out of Ferguson, characterizes them as they're helping to guard property owners during these riots, characterizes Oath Keepers as instigators. So we got a representative there, Emmanuel Cleaver. Is he any relation to Beaver? I don't know. Anyway, he says those with guns at demonstrations were not demonstrators. They were instigators. No, the Oath Keepers are not demonstrating and they're not instigating. What they're doing is they are peacefully standing there as a deterrent to any violence. They're doing what the police ought to do if the police really were concerned about keeping the peace. Instead, what we've seen is the police acting as provocateurs. And we've seen this in Ferguson all along. We've talked about how Ferguson seems to be picked by the George Soros Black Lives Matter people, as well as Southern Poverty Law Center, to push their agenda. We've had a lot of police brutality cases, a lot of people murdered by the police. Very clear cases, and yet those were mostly ignored, never given the kind of attention that we saw in Ferguson. And so you have to look at this and you have to say, is this deliberate? Is this something that is unique about Ferguson? Or did they pick a place where there is some ambiguity about whether the policeman was protecting his life? Nevertheless, the contempt that they showed in the community by leaving Michael Brown's body there in the street, bleeding out for hours, obviously not trying to help him, and just leaving it there, I think, as an open show of contempt, inflamed the community. And I can understand with everything that's going on all across the country. We have been talking about black lives here at InfoWars, and we've been talking about white lives, and we've been talking about the fact that the rule of law matters as well as our lives, because we have no rule of law. No one's life is protected. I think that when you look at what the Black Lives Matter organization, and of course we've seen how they are complaining about they didn't get their check from the Soros people and so forth. By focusing on black lives only, they are doing something that is guaranteed to fail. Look, if you're the minority and you're being put upon at a higher rate than everybody else, because let's understand, everybody is getting harassed, is getting bullied, is getting brutalized, is getting killed by the many police all over the country. This is a problem that is not local to Ferguson. This is a problem that is nationwide, and it's about the militarization of the police. This is coming out of Washington. And I understand that it's happening in the black community more than it is in the white community, but it is happening in the white community as well. Why, if you're a minority, why would you not want to try to get people to understand that it's everyone's problem so he could reach a solution. You see, Martin Niemöller, we've mentioned this many times, the fellow who said, first they came for this group and I did nothing because I wasn't a part of that group. Then they came for the other group and I did nothing for them because I wasn't a part of that group. We talk about this all the time in terms of police brutality, especially when it is black people. We're always trying to get the white people to understand that they are at risk. They have been killed by out-of-control SWAT teams going into innocent homes, as well as black people. It happens more frequently in black homes. But you're not going to solve this problem unless everybody understands that they are at risk. So when you keep something, if it, and it is, affecting the minorities more frequently, if you say it's only their problem and anybody else is not allowed to talk about it, if you do, you're racist. And if you don't say it's only about black people, then you're racist. No, if you say it's only about black people, first of all, you're lying. Secondly, what you're trying to do is foment a divide and conquer. You're trying to push this militarization. Now, let's look at what's behind this. We played the report from Alex Jones in the last segment. Total emergency alert. The elite are now evacuating. Look at this article on Infowars.com. The U.S. economy continues its collapse. This is from Paul Craig Roberts. And he points out that the Clintons, when Clinton was in charge, they changed the unemployment figures. They've got one that looks at people that are just now still looking for it. At that measure, it is 5%. If they extend it out a little bit further, it's 10%. If you put it out the way it used to be, long-term unemployment, you're looking at 23%. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
I feel like this all the time, trying to politically awaken people that they're being lied to, that there's an agenda. It's not left or right. It's, hey, there's mind control going on. The signals broadcast 24 hours a day through all this media. Just become aware of it, and they'll say, there's nothing going on. And I want to say, put on these glasses or start chewing concrete.
They have taken the hearts and minds of our leaders. They have recruited the rich and the powerful. And they have blinded us to the truth.
The question is, do we all work for central bankers? That's what I want to address to our guest tonight.
Our impulses are being redirected. We are living in an artificially induced state of consciousness that resembles sleep.
An estimated 50 to 70 million Americans suffer from a sleep disorder or sleep deprivation.
Outside the limit of our sight, feeding off us, perched on top of us from birth to death, are our owners.
Latest census numbers prove the United States has the biggest gap between rich and poor compared to all westernized countries today.
Our projections show that by the year 2025, not only America, but the entire planet will be under the protection and the dominion of this power alliance. The gains have been substantial, both for ourselves and for you, the human power elite.
For the first time in all of human history, mankind is politically awakened. That's a total new reality.
I've got one that can see.
We can't be the only ones who can see.
Unfortunately, you've grown up hearing voices that incessantly warn of government as nothing more than some separate, sinister entity that's got them at the root of all our problems.
It's a new morning in America. Fresh. Vital. The old cynicism is gone. We have faith in our leaders. We're optimistic as to what becomes of it all. It really boils down to our ability to accept. We don't need pessimism.
I have two words for you. Predator drones.
And who are you, little fella?
You will never see it coming.
And I'm predicting the first guy who uses a Second Amendment weapon to bring a drone down that's been hovering over his house is going to be a folk hero in this country.
Nice.
There is a signal broadcast every second of every day through our television sets.
I'm just trying to warn you folks, the television is a giant LED weapon system. It's so advanced. They got a monkey farm in Bastrop, folks, that they do all sorts of testing on great apes, rhesus monkeys, the whole nine yards. And they go, oh, you didn't see this, and punch a button, and it'd be hundreds of monkeys with wires in their brains with television sets brainwashing them.
All I ever have to do is be famous. People watch me, and they love me.
You
you can have a little taste of that good life, too. Now, I know you want it. Hell, everybody does.
Do it to your own kind.
What's the threat? We all sell out every day. Might as well be on the winning team.
The real men of the world have to stand up and say,
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
And I'm all out of bubblegum. Time to take a stand, boys. You know what? You got a little courage. Stand up for yourself.
Waging war on corruption. It's Alex Jones coming to you live from the front lines of the InfoWar.
The Oscar winners give a press conference and how to buy a sailboat as...
Again, that's a great tribute to Roddy Piper, as well as the movie They Live, updating that with what's going on at this very moment. Can the world get any stranger? Well, yes, it can. Here's an article from Slate saying AI the wed. Humans should be able to marry robots. Yeah, folks, no matter how strange you think it gets even stranger. Now, of course, we've been talking about what's going on in Ferguson. We have two reporters who are there. Alex is going to be interviewing them in the third hour. Alex is going to be joining us shortly live in the studio. He's working on a very important story. Of course, much of what's happened in Ferguson has now been spun to be about InfoWars and about the Oath Keepers. We're there to report it. Other reporters have been arrested there in Ferguson. But the reporters are coming under attack. The peacekeepers, like Oath Keepers, are coming under attack. This is, I believe, and we've said this many times, why Ferguson, why this particular case would be given so much attention? Why would they be so obviously and blatantly incompetent, announcing the verdict at the time that they'd been having riots and mass demonstrations, doing that at night at 8 o'clock to provoke the crowd? Everything seems to be designed to provoke the crowd. And, of course, they don't want anybody who is going to stand there peacefully with arms as a deterrent, because the presence of firearms by peaceful people is a deterrence to looting. It's very simple. That's one of the reasons why the police won't do it. They want the place to burn down, as we've seen elsewhere. They make that very, very clear. We were talking in the last break about the article from Paul Craig Roberts, who is the assistant treasury secretary under Ronald Reagan. He was talking about what the real unemployment rate is. You tell people the real unemployment rate is 23% and they scoff at you. They say, that's nonsense. It's 5%. It's really good. Well, he breaks it down for you, because our government has several different measures. And Paul Craig Roberts points out that we don't have honest reporting of this. We don't have honest collection of these statistics either. He says the so-called recovery is based on the U3 measure of the unemployment rate. This does not include any unemployed person who's been discouraged from inability to find work and hasn't looked for a job in just 4 weeks. So you go 4 weeks and you say, well, I'm not looking for a job. I don't know how they get that from people, presumably if you're on unemployment. I don't really understand how they know, but let's just go with the fact that they do know. But they cut it off at 4 weeks. So if you're not looking for a job, after 4 weeks, they don't count you. Then you've got another one called the U6. This is another one that the government also used, and it's another official measurement. That one is over 10%, over twice as much as U3, because that takes people who are discouraged and not looking for a job, and that is for less than 1 year. Those have been discouraged for less than 1 year and still unemployed. However, he points out that going back to 1994, Clinton wanted to look like his economy was better than Reagan. So what they did was they removed the true unemployment rate. That is long-term workers who still haven't gotten a job. They say, well, these people haven't gotten a job over a certain period of time. Then I think that they are discouraged. And so they're not really looking, so we can take them out of the unemployment rolls. Not necessarily true. If you look at that, and he points out John Williams of ShadowStats.com has continued to measure that since 1994 in the same way that the government used to measure it and used to report it. By that standard, in July 2015, the unemployment rate is 23%. So if we were being honest, if we were comparing it back to the unemployment rates that we used to measure back in this country, we would not have 5% unemployment. We would have over 23% unemployment. But we also have other problems. And of course, the problems are focusing this demonization campaign, pitting one group against another, pitting blacks against whites, men against women, not trying to solve our fundamental common problems. And as I mentioned in the last segment, if you're part of a minority, if you think that Black Lives Matter, the only way that you're going to effectively protect Black lives is to make common cause with the larger group, to get the larger group to understand that their lives are at stake as well. And they are. There's a lot of white people. There's a lot of people of every race that are being killed by this out-of-control, militarized police state. People of every race are losing due process. Yes, it is worse for the black community. All the more reason for them to make common cause. Yet this is what we see. Look at this article that we have on InfoWars.com from Paul Joseph Watson. Media launches new demonization campaign as Oath Keepers arrive in Ferguson. And he shows a tweet from a previous, when they were there last time, when the last time the riots were happening. Black Ferguson business owners begged Oath Keepers to help them last time. And he shows a picture of a black business owner along with an Oath Keeper who protected her business. And he says, why is Black Lives Matters against this? Why would you oppose this? These people are protecting businesses of everyone, not white only, white, black, Asian, anyone who asks them, they're standing there protecting them, offering peace in the community as a deterrent to looters. They're not threatening anyone, but they are now being threatened by the local law enforcement. This other headline, Missouri rep says, take out Oath Keepers in Ferguson, and characterizes them as instigators. This is Representative Emmanuel Cleaver. No, that is not what's happening. And as D-Ray McKesson, who is a leader in the Black Lives Matter, tweeted out, this is what he said about InfoWars reporters as well as Oath Keepers yesterday. He said, the Oath Keepers in Ferguson have said they are there to protect InfoWars, a conspiracy theory site against Black Lives Matter. Be careful. Again, trying to pit one group against another. They're not threatening anybody. They're not a threat to anyone who's doing this. And then another guy comes back and says, Alex Jones is racist, and his site, InfoWars, has an agenda to stop Black Lives Matter movement. No, we have an agenda to stop the division, the divide and conquer strategy of George Soros. We have exposed that many times. And we have the protesters there declaring that they are ready for war as America's impoverished inner cities threaten to erupt. That's what we've seen from the headlines from the New York Times, from others. They have blocked interstates there. We're going to be, as I said, talking to our reporters who are there live in the third hour. That's going to be Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs. Alex will be talking to them. And Alex will also be interviewing legendary astronaut Story Musgrave. Interesting, this story that came out. Astronauts declare the first space salad to be awesome. So now they are growing food in the International Space Station. They're trying to get a longer presence for astronauts so they can get to a farther reach. And nevertheless, what is happening here? Perhaps they'll do some kind of a genetically modified thing. Maybe they won't. Maybe they'll get some real fresh food. Now, before we go to a special report, I just want to let you know that this segment of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by Supermail Vitality. We've had that out of stock for quite some time. It came back in stock last Friday. Our new emergency shipment arrived then. We know that our bodies are under hormonal attack, and it's time to fight back. This new ultra-strength Supermail Vitality formula has hundreds of five-star reviews. It's truly life-changing. You can go and read these reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. It's a great way to decide whether or not the product is right for you. Let me read you one of those. Tiago from London says, I am very happy for having ever tried Supermail Vitality. While Alex ships to the UK, I will always buy this product. It's great in all ways, from the strength to the vitality to the endurance. I can confirm that today. I can reach farther with this product. I have looked into the ingredients. They're safe and great. He says, thanks. Take a look at the reviews that you find there at InfoWarsLife.com and decide if it's the right product for you. Again, we have Supermail Vitality back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, one of the things is we've been talking about politics in the last week, and Alex was here yesterday talking to callers trying to get their take on what they felt about Donald Trump, what's going on with the campaign. Of course, one of the things I'm struck by is the fact that if you go to Donald Trump's campaign website, There's absolutely not a single issue there. I've never seen anybody run for dog catcher that didn't have an issue as to why they were running. I'm running because I want to fix this. This is a problem, and here's my solution. Everyone, no matter how low the office, has always had that up. Here's a guy running for president simply on the strength of his personality and the number of followers that he has on Facebook, because that's what he talks about. That and his press releases and about his back and forth with Fox News. If we dig, however, we can find some of the things that he's been talking about. Of course, he was for abortion before he's now against it. We've heard him say 25 years ago that he was for decriminalization of drugs. He thought that was the only way to stop the violent crime. I agree with that, but I don't hear him saying that now. He's changed his tune on many issues. And of course, maybe one of those issues, we never heard what he thought about the surveillance state, but he did say on Fox News that Ed Snowden is a, quote, total traitor and should be executed. So that kind of gives you a feeling as to why he, as well as the rest of the people besides Rand Paul and the GOP, are not going to be talking about doing anything about the surveillance state. Of course, the Democrats aren't going to be talking about that either. There's not anybody in either of the mainstream parties, except for Rand Paul, that seems to have a problem with violating the Fourth Amendment for every single American. As we saw in the debate, Chris Christie said, we have to get these records because otherwise, how are we going to know if the people aren't terrorists? In other words, you are all guilty. And only until they spy on you, put you in their database, then that's the only way that you're going to know, they're going to know whether or not they can trust you. You're all guilty. You're all terrorists. They need to spy on everything you do. And when you look at how this is playing out with the various intelligence mining that they're doing in the pre-crime, it is very, very scary.
Thank you so much for joining us on this Tuesday, the 11th day already of August 2015. You know, there's an old saying from Italy that a cobbler's children have no shoes. And of course, a cobbler is a shoemaker. A cobbler's children have no shoes. And when we look at it from that perspective, I have no time to work on the big investigative reports, the big investigative stories, the big breaking news, the vetting of stories, the dealing with crises, because I'm kind of like the overall news director. And then I wear the hat of a radio, TV host, documentary filmmaker, news website runner, all those other things I deal with. And so that's why sometimes you'll have David Knight just suddenly in here because I can't make it on air. And David Knight, by the way, does a fabulous job. Different strokes for different folks, different personalities, different overall flavor, but overall the same research and understanding of world events and the same desire to promote freedom. And that's why David is so popular with our audience. And I appreciate him filling in on about 30 minutes short notice today because I had a family issue that came up and I was working on a big story this morning previous to that. Obviously, we have a big broadcast lined up for you today. In the third hour, we're going to have popping in Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs. They're up there covering the state of civil emergency in Ferguson that could be a microcosm for things to come in the rest of the country. And CBS News, we have the newscast, just came out and said that there were armed vigilantes there hired by InfoWars in confrontations with the locals. And then we went and watched the video, and we called Joe Biggs, and we talked to the Oath Keepers, and the media asked Oath Keepers, why are you here? Well, I'm here to protect the public. I'm here to protect the press. And out of that, they're now hired by us, and they're vigilantes. This is how media lies. And Rob Due has called CBS local, but it's also been put out national, and said, look, just you've got to retract this. But in the past, media was not this deceptive. They would still lie some, but I mean, now the gloves are off. And we've seen them more and more engage in things like this. There's no way. Their own CBS report
doesn't have the militiaman, the oath keeper, saying that. I mean, if you had that, you'd show it on tape. Then they just have it in the voiceover that they said that. It's like when MSNBC goes, the Boston bombers did it. They were influenced by Alex Jones, and he's deeply racist. And then they don't show where I influenced him, not a shred of evidence. And then they don't show where I'm racist, deeply racist, excuse me. It's just what I call preying on your audience, predatory media preying on their audience. Now, I've been tied up with some other big stories concerning Jade Helm and other research we're doing right now. I was talking to Nico, one of the head producers, yesterday, and he said, you know whose story Musgrave is? And I said, well, yeah, of course I do. That's the U.S. astronaut with the most flight time and most time in space of any American. You could debate whether Russians have spent more time in space. He's the designer of Skylab, flew the first shuttle missions, helped design the shuttle off Wernher von Braun's basic design. Was in the Marines back in the early 50s, was a part of the early astronaut program, was an astronaut in 67, retired in the late 90s. He's an MD. He's got like 7 degrees, an engineer. I mean, you talk about an astronaut's astronaut. He's going to be joining us, and I haven't talked to him yet. I got his number yesterday. He said, feel free to call him. I just was never got around to it. Plus, you're kind of intimidated, you know, calling these people up. See, a rock star, I got some friends that are major rock stars. I think they're really cool. People like Joe Perry or Dave Mustaine or Billy Corrigan. Those are the folks that have been public about being patriots. A lot of others, even bigger, if you can believe it, who were scared to be public. And I like their music. Grew up listening to it. I admire them because they're cool people that have the courage to speak out knowing they can be attacked. But I don't get butterflies around them. I've talked a lot about this. I mean, I've been to A-list Hollywood parties. I'm not name-dropping. I'm just, it's a sociological paradigm for me. And been around the biggest names in Hollywood. The biggest names. Not just the ones you've heard here that are up there, but folks even bigger. The biggest names. And I don't get butterflies. Quite frankly, it's a little boring. I want to get back to Texas. Not because of them, but the folks that are around them, the emptiness of the culture. But I get around engineers, scientists, code breakers, astronauts, fighter pilots, people that are trailblazers, deep divers that can, you know, dive, free dive down 1,000 feet. That's the most dangerous sport there is. Industrial divers, submarine rescue people. The head of Veterans for Peace locally, Don Darling, was a captain of a famous submarine rescue system that rescued people at thousands of feet, some of the deepest dives ever. I mean, you're around that. These are exceptional humans. And I get giddy around them. Anyways, I didn't call him yesterday because I'm intimidated to call him. He came to Austin. He was here. He wanted to meet me. He tried to find out how to meet me. That's where it gets even weirder. Says I admire him, and I guess he likes me. I haven't talked to him yet, and we get a hold of him. He's going to come on the show and said he wants to discuss whatever we want to get into. And I know he's been involved in the secret space program, everything else. American physician, retired NASA astronaut. His brother died on the same ship he was on. Aircraft carrier. I guess it was the Wasp. I've got his Wikipedia here. In a crash, and the aircraft carrier ran over him. I mean, just an interesting person. There's no way to even go over his whole bio. Truth is more amazing than fiction. And so the real Buck Rogers is going to be joining us coming up. And I don't know what he's going to drop on us, because we've had people on like Buzz Aldrin, second guy to walk on the moon. And yeah, folks, they went to the moon. And you know, he starts bringing up all sorts of wild stuff about, you want to go to the moon of Mars? It's got the obelisk. It's connected to the pyramids. That's all I can tell you. It's classified, Alex. And then he told me classified stuff in Hollywood about how they'd already discovered water on the moon. They were going to let the Indians crash a probe, and how it'd be on the news in 6 months, and it was. So, I mean, these guys really know about the dark side of the moon, if you know what I mean. It's all coming up, and we're going to be coming in with You Got It from Crystal Method. In the next segment, for obvious reasons, has got astronauts in the background talking. Story Musgrave, with the most flight time of any American in space, only beaten by the Russian records. One of the main designers of Skylab, our first major space station. First to fly the shuttle, the only person to fly on all five shuttles. Medical doctor, psychologist, he's like 7 degrees. Was back. He was in the Marine Corps in the early 50s. His brother died in the Marine Corps as a Marine aviator. Just such an interesting person, interesting family. And he's going to be joining us coming up. And, you know, I don't know why he reached out to us. I haven't talked to him. I'd rather just do it live on air. But I would imagine it's because my show's well known to be very, very negative about negative things that are happening, but also very, very positive about the power of humanity and how we've got to go to the next level of a type one civilization off this planet to survive. We've got to have goals as a species that are voluntary, but if they're powerful enough ideas, the majority of people will get behind it. We need an elite that's ready to empower humanity and build a technological system based around humans and life and the planet, which go hand in hand. I know I was invited to speak at Oxford, and I said, what do you want me to speak about? Because it was the main Oxford group. I didn't go. I don't know why I didn't go. But then and I'm not bragging, but they said, well, some of the faculty, some of the people want to hear you speak about, you know, a positive view for humanity, your promotion of space. And it's not that I'm some expert on any of this. It's just an obvious gut-level response, a genetic response of our species that's always trailblazing, always wandering, always searching, always innovating. The master builder species. And so Story Musgrave, I mean, other than somebody like Neil Armstrong, or maybe a Buzz Aldrin, there's nobody more important at NASA. And I just wish, when I was in Europe, turns out he was in town and wanted to come in studio. So the next time he's in Austin, or let's fly him out here, that's coming up. And I don't know where to begin when he comes on the show. We've got all this other news to cover, but of course Donald Trump's coming out basically in defense of Planned Parenthood now, you know, saying, oh, we should keep it open in non-abortion services. What does that even mean? And I'm not here to attack Donald Trump. I like what he's saying on a lot of fronts. It's just that we need to not just hold people up like messianic saviors. I don't like Bernie Sanders and his socialist ideas, but I think at a lot of levels, you know, he goes after the big banks. I want to think that he's at least for real so I can respect him, but not with statements like this. Bernie Sanders' criticism of Hillary is sexist, close quote. You know what? I don't criticize Hillary because she's a woman. It's very insulting to use mindless tactics like that when they know full well this woman's involved in Benghazi. She's involved in Fast and Furious. She's involved in the foundation scams. She's involved in everything you can imagine. And we don't need political dynasties based on family names anymore. It needs to be on merit, like Story Musgrave, who came from nowhere, but because of his skills, ended up being the top astronaut in the NASA program for decades. Just like Admiral Nimitz came from nowhere, from Fredericksburg, Texas, but because of merit in the Navy, he became the head of the Pacific Navy in World War II. And, you know, this country became great because we really were, more than any other nation, people came here because of this. If you were born in Italy, or you were born in Russia, you were born in Japan, you couldn't go anywhere if you weren't in that class. America was about merit, and that's why people came here. And Hillary Clinton has been given everything she's got, and I'm sick of her. I don't like men like that. I don't like women like that. I'm tired of it. Americans like people that did it on their own, working with others, but had the initiative. And that's what we need to get back to if we're going to be a great country and a great planet. I mean, that's a no-brainer. I'm not saying anything that isn't already known here. It's not sexist to criticize Hillary Clinton. I can't believe they're going to use this in the campaign, but you knew they were. It was just a little over 100 years ago that the Wright brothers first had the first powered flight at Kitty Hawk. And now look where we are today. You can fly anywhere in the world in 20 hours or so. And so we think of space as something that really is unattainable, but it is attainable. And more we see moves towards only putting robots in space and building a technological world where humans are basically obsolete. But on the tip of the spear promoting humans in control of technology is Dr. Story Musgrave, And I won't go over his huge bio because it would take the whole hour we have with him. But of all the astronauts out there, we've had Buzz Aldrin on, amazing, one of the first people to walk on the moon, and many others. I'm really blown away to have Mr. Musgrave on because I remember being a little kid and my dad watching Skylab on television and talking about how amazing it was. And he was involved in designing Skylab, one of the first people on the shuttle, the only astronaut to fly on all five shuttles. I know he was involved in a lot of other classified NASA stuff, a medical doctor, you name it. And, of course, he doesn't want to talk about himself, but, I mean, we need to celebrate role models like this doctor, this astronaut that we have on with us, Story Musgrave, because, quite frankly, when we only celebrate Hollywood people or folks that can throw a ball in a basket, it really skews the civilization. If you go back to the founding of this country that had the most inventions and the most innovation, it was all based on trailblazing. It was all based on challenging, inventing. That was the culture then. Those were the rock stars, the icons of 1776, really the flower of the Renaissance. And so in this world where we give some of these corporate CEOs, you know, $3, $4 billion bonuses when they get government bailouts, we're told that we don't have money for NASA. We don't have money to go to space. Well, we've seen the private space program. It's very daring and I support. And we've seen the deaths and the crashes there. And so it is out there on the edge of that envelope, the right stuff, that we find the men and women that really do exemplify the human spirit. And if we don't truly get a foothold in space, we're never going to save this planet. I believe we're meant to save this planet, but use it as a jumping off point to the next level of human development that we're so close to. Now, enough of me ranting. You can read his NASA bio at nasa.gov. You can obviously go to Wikipedia. It's basically the same thing. But Dr. Musgrave was selected as a scientist astronaut in 67. He'd been in the Marine Corps back in the early 50s before that. In August of 67, Dr. Musgrave participated in the design and development of all space shuttle activity equipment, including spacesuits, life support systems, airlocks, and manned maneuvering units. And he was involved again in some of the first flights of the Challenger, all five of the space shuttles, designing Skylab, being on Skylab. He spent 1,281 hours, 59 minutes, 22 seconds in space. He's the only astronaut, again, to be on all five space shuttles. Prior to John Glenn's return to space in 98, Musgrave held the record for the oldest person in orbit at 61. In 96, he became the second astronaut to achieve the record of six space flights, and he's the only formally educated astronaut with seven academic degrees. He retired from NASA in 97. StoryMusgrave.com. He's also a multi-time best-selling author and has flown in hundreds of different aircraft. And I'm going to stop his bio right there. It's an interesting story. I was in Europe for 2 weeks reporting on the economic situation there, collapsing Africa, and I learned that he'd been in town and had reached out to see if we could meet. And then he's left Austin now, so we called him. He's on the show with us today, and I hope we can get him on in the future via Skype or in studio. But Dr. Musgrave, thank you so much for coming on the broadcast with us.
You're welcome, sir. And my biggest accomplishment is standing right here to talk to you, and that's my daughter, little Story Musgrave.
Hi, Alex.
Hi, how you doing?
Good.
And she's 9 years old, and I'm gonna let her go now. She's going to go back to the tractors, so she drives tractors. She's got her own ATV, and she drives 360 mowers, and she does that kind of stuff. She's getting the same kind of raising that I did, so she'll be ready for the rocket world when the time comes. Bye-bye, sweetie.
Bye.
Okay, you weren't expecting that, were you?
No, but it's awesome. Listen, I've done my little intro. Obviously, the audience wants to know, what do you know about the InfoWar and the broadcast? We're flattered that you're a listener, sir.
What do I know? I'm not sure what I know. I've just been to your site and stuff, that's all.
Well, it's good to have you on the broadcast.
I haven't heard the program, so are you mostly an Austin audience?
Sure, well, you were telling me you'd seen some of the videos online and stuff, but I was just curious about, I'm just flattered that you reached out to us. We're honored to have you. So,
are you mostly an Austin audience?
We're all over the place.
Oh, it reaches further?
Yes, sir.
Well, I love Austin, man. Austin's a going town. Austin's everything. Austin's the future. Well, so they got the high tech, the beautiful geography, the beautiful people, the great ambiance. You know, it's the future. And so I got two kids that live there, too.
Well, that's why we've got you on. You're somebody that can tell us about the future. Where do you want to start?
About the future?
Yes. Where would you? I mean, there's so much to discuss.
Well, there's some complicated things, and that's why complexity is arising. I know your audience can handle it. The complexity of Mother Earth is arising. And the complexity, of course, the advanced evolutionary string, which we are, in other words, biology is massively complex. It became that way. But then the silicon world, that world is becoming more and more powerful, more and more complex, and it's tighter and tighter in connections, interconnections between biology, that's us, and that world. And so you can look upon, and it's a painting I did for Intel. It kind of reflects that entire increase in complexity. But for starts, that's one way the world's going.
Well, obviously, I want to get into NASA. What, summing up NASA, where do you think it's going right now?
I don't know where it's going right now because there's no long-term vision and there's no short-term vision. So they need to get a vision. And so it starts everything, whether it's a corporation or a group or a family, they need a vision for what they want the future to be and how to make the future, you know, and how to get on that plan and get going. So you must have a vision, and then you have leadership to the vision, and then you have to have what's called project management, which will make it happen. That's what it gets down to, not just for NASA, for every institution, every person, every family. What is the vision for the future? You get leadership that will communicate the vision, make it happen, and then project management is like systems. So project management looks at every single detail that needs to be managed and run to get to the finish line. That's what it's about, Alex.
What was your favorite mission of all your NASA missions?
Well, of course, I'm most well-known for being the Hubble repair mission, lead mechanic to repair Hubble. I got that, of course, because I'm a product of child labor and a teenage Marine aircraft mechanic. I drove tanks, tank mechanic, all that stuff. But that's the one that's most notable. But I didn't just go and fix it. I designed it for 18 years. So when I say I did these things, I don't mean I did them. I mean I helped. But I was the astronaut that was there to design Hubble for serviceability and maintainability. Starting in 1975, they told me to look after that machine, identify every failure that it could get into, and it's hundreds of them. I am to identify the failures, and I am to come up with a spacewalk and tools and procedures to fix it. So that's that. And after 18 years, I went to fix it. That's my best-known mission, but one of my most ambitious missions was my second one on Challenger, and that was an astronomy mission. 4 ultraviolet telescopes, infrared telescope, cosmic ray telescope, X-ray telescope. My goodness, we were that kind of observatory. So we were running an observatory. That was a massively, maybe the most aggressive mission NASA's ever flown. But it doesn't get so much attention. You know, it's an observatory. But that was massively demanding. But when you ask me, you know, what missions do I get excited about, I get most excited about the missions I have to design. So I have to design a mission. So here's the job that needs to get done, and you and Mission Control design a mission to get that job done. Sometimes you get handed a very mature technology that's been flown before, and all you do is do the checklist. And the checklist is what switch, it's what rotary, and what's input to a computer display. And then you've flown the mission. And so all you do is like a monkey, learn on what page to be, what book and what page, what knob to turn, switch, and item entry to a computer.
Sure. I saw a speech you gave, and you talked about, though, if you don't do these things right, people die.
Well, I've been living that kind of game since age 16 when I soloed. I got to get it right the first time. I got to get it right every time. So I've had the privilege, Alex, of being on that kind of playing field. I've been on 100 playing fields. You go through life. That's what life is for everyone. Not just me, you and everyone listening out there. Life is an opportunity. So you look in the mirror today, this is my skill set. What is the intersection of the native talents that I came into the world with and my parents gave me? What experience, what education have I had, and where is my passion? Number one, where is my passion? The passion guarantees you'll put the energy into what you got to do to get there. So passion is number one thing on where you go next. Do you have a passion?
So you've got to have vision. You've got to have passion. And it seems like the culture that's promoted now, they're not really promoting vision or passion in individuals.
Yes, because true passion is important. Well, everyone knows that.
Why do you think that is? Why do you think that is that we're not seeing passion and focus and goals really being promoted by the power structure these days? It seems like there's not really a culture at all.
Oh, I see what you mean. The power structure, you're talking Washington, I guess.
Yes.
No, the passion doesn't play much of a thing. It's supposed to be logical and rational somehow. But, of course, you can be logical and rational and still have passion. But I guarantee you, sir, if any entrepreneurial company is going to get out the door, I guarantee you every person in that company is rabid with passion. You don't do entrepreneurial stuff and get out the door without it. And if you look at all the great companies of the world, those people believe. They believe in that company. They believe in what they're doing. And belief means they're in the game.
Story Musgrave is our guest. Wow, I mean, you've been on all five of the spacecraft that of course, wasn't it originally the space shuttle designed or a simpler version by Wernher von Braun, or is that incorrect?
He designed a lot of stuff, sir. Wernher von Braun, who I knew very, very well. I met him, by the way, I flew the airplane by his window. He saw it as someone different flying that airplane. He called a field up and asked who flying that. Story Musgrave, can you join me for lunch? From that day forward, whenever he saw an airplane flying that way, I had lunch with him. I knew him very well. But that's a guy, Alex, who read science fiction. So he believed. He believed from a teenager. He went to Herman Oberth, who was the world's leading rocket expert at the time. He went as a teenager to that man to learn space flight, to learn rocketry. And he did it as a teenager. Then, of course, he progressed through life. He got a PhD in physics. He became a rocket person. And unfortunately, his country at the time, Germany, his country at the time, wanted him to drop V2s on London. So serving his country, he did that. Not good, and he didn't like doing that. But he came to this country, and away you go. But the man was science fiction. The man was a dreamer. The man was one of the greatest visionaries we had. The man was incredibly close to Walt Disney and that kind of thinking. So there you had it. You had a great visionary.
Sure. I mean, didn't he pretty much invent cruise missiles, you name it? He came up with the idea for the circular cities in space, the space shuttle.
Yeah, he did that. He had endless visions. He had endless visions for space flight. So the one you mentioned, maybe he had that vision too. So he had space stations, he had Mars, he had all those visions, but we let him go after we got to the moon. The very year we landed on the moon, we let him go. And so we let go, really, the best visionary we had.
How is it that they can't recreate now, they're saying, the Saturn rockets, and we have to use Russian heavy lifters in 2015? I mean, it seems like there's a conspiracy somewhere to sabotage American space program.
Yes, sir. We cannot understand that at all. So the company, the greatest rocket company in history, was called North American Rocketdyne, North American Aviation, and they owned Rocketdyne. And so, when von Braun said go, when we were told to go to the moon, 3 years later, a Saturn lifted off. Now it takes us 15 years to develop a rocket. The Saturns never had a catastrophic failure, not ever. They took us to the moon. They took us where we wanted to go. So, why don't we just do Saturns? They're 50 years old, but they're still better than anything we got today. But that is a critical issue, which is not being raised, and that's why are we all so unreliable with rocket engines. Now, General Electric jet engines, and yes, there's Pratt & Whitney, Rolls-Royce, and the rest, but I just want to be particular. GE jet engines are incredibly complex. They're incredibly powerful. When you get on an airplane and you're going from here to Johannesburg, you're going to get 17 hours across the waters. Both engines got to work, and both engines always work, sir. Their reliability is at 9 decimal places. Jet engines, the reliability is at 9 decimal places. When you go to Austin there, you go to Bergstrom, get on an airplane, It's 8 decimal places. Anything bad going to happen to you? It's 1 in almost a billion. Anything going to happen to you? So they have built reliability into that system, commercial air, including jet engines. They cannot do that in rocketry. They can't arrive at configuration, have what they're doing based on the pedigree of process of earlier successes. In other words, configuration, live with it, best practices, and continuous improvement. They're unable to do that in the rocket world.
And is that because they're always trying to start something new? As you said, build on what we know is reliable.
We don't build on what we know, sir. We don't do that. And we don't have any way of capturing what we know. And a rocket engine, the people expect it to blow up. The last 3 rockets on the way to space station, 3 in a row blew up.
Yeah, it's sabotage.
And so, well, I don't know. It's just it's ideation sabotage. It's just, now, what are we doing here? You know, what are we doing? But a rocket is a chamber.
Sure, when I say sabotage, I mean culturally from Washington, what's going on. Because, I mean, you heard my intro. If we don't have goals, you know this better than I do, if we don't have role models promoted to school children like you and others, we don't have any future. I mean, when my dad was a kid, his idols were people like you, other astronauts. Now, young people don't even know who Chuck Yeager is, who's a listener of the show, by the way. It's just crazy that we've gotten to this point. So I'm saying, how do we, as you said, Wernher von Braun was a fan over 100 years ago of science fiction. So he envisioned the modern space system we have today that so much of our civilization's based on. And then now we see what humans can envision we can ultimately build. But instead, imagination's been taken away so the technological elite that Eisenhower warned us about can quietly, on their own, more secretive reservations, develop the technological world in the direction they want, while we're given a stagnated, slow-moving technological development. That is my view of what's happening.
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
How do we break free of that Story Musgrave, the American with the most space time?
It's called a vision. Build a vision. It's called build a vision. They can't turn down.
That's right.
But you know, now NASA are not interested in building a vision. NASA does not have a vision. They don't think it's their job, sir. NASA salutes now. NASA simply stands up and salutes the administration and salutes the Congress and tries to get the Congress to do what the administration wants done. NASA doesn't understand. The administration doesn't run the program. The only thing you get to do is what you got money for. And you can't do things you don't have the money allocated for. But the NASA no longer does the vision. They salute and they accept the role they're handed. And that's no money and no vision. When's the last vision NASA came up with? A long-term vision or even a short-term vision? They don't do vision anymore, and they don't think they should.
Absolutely. And they have mainstream media put out the conspiracy theory and give it credence that we didn't go to the moon to also sabotage our worldview, when I have personal friends who were on the mission on the ground, like Raymond Teague, and he said we absolutely did go to the moon. And so putting the idea out that we didn't, what, I didn't fly to Europe in 9 hours last week. The Wright brothers didn't fly. My cell phone isn't more powerful than the most powerful computer 20 years ago. Of course all this is real.
Yeah, I don't know. With a medium power telescope, you can see our spacecraft on the moon.
Absolutely, and we've got the laser reflectors.
Sure, exactly. The laser, what sends that laser back? And so, and Al Shepard, how come his golf ball went forever? And when Dave Scott dropped a hammer and a feather and they fell at the same speed, hey, what are we talking about here?
Well, I'll tell you, I figured it out. There are elements in the government that actually put out the fake photos and the rest of it, put it into the NASA material to create this conspiracy to kill the space program. It is deliberate, it's at every level, and it is to stifle human development, and it's the Club of Rome. They've said openly they want a feudalist system where technology is frozen, Doctor. That's my view.
I see. Well, I don't know Washington, sir. I've never worked it. I've had the privilege of not working it.
I know you helped build NASA. I mean, you don't like to brag, but you—I mean, it says here, just in mainline literature, that you were in—that you were a main innovator on the shuttle, Skylab. You name it.
That's creativity from the bottom up, sir. I was a bottoms-up person. I came from the bottom. You know, vision and stuff can come from the top or come from the bottom. I'm a bottom person. It's just where I am.
Well, let's talk about your view from the bottom going all the way to the top. Let's talk about what it's like in space. Let's talk about some of your books. And I want you to guide the discussion when we come back. And I want to invite you. I'd love to fly you here. Oh, I forgot. That's a conspiracy theory. We don't have that technology. I want to invite him to walk here by horse and carriage. Story Musgrave to Austin, Texas. He joins us right now via the telephone for radio and TV listeners. StoryMusgrave.com. A true American icon. So we're told by the social engineers that the age of humans is over, that the age of silicon is upon us. And the transhumanists, that is the dominant transhumanists, they're not all bad, basically say that humans are obsolete. I don't agree with that view. Humanity is amazing. We've done amazing things. And people like Dr. Story Musgrave are on the tip of the spear. Again, from a farm boy to the Marine Corps as a mechanic to, you know, 7 degrees and being a science astronaut officer in 1967 and having more space flights than any other astronaut in the United States. That's amazing. And we sit here in the middle of this universe, this wonder, this planet, spinning around this sun, way out on the edge of the spiral arm of the Milky Way galaxy, and we let the politicians and the infighting and the race baiting and the racist and all the distractions and the mainstream media diversions dominate our world. We have to transcend the globalist and have our own vision for humanity. And as our guest said, make the vision so good, people gotta buy into it. Free will. And that's why there's a cultural dumbing down. Because the social engineers, and I've read their books, I've read their writings, I've had them on the show, they say if the general public ever gets into a culture of liberty, a culture of innovation, then it can't be centralized. Those systems don't go along with totalitarianism. And that's why we're told that we're failures and that we're bad and that we're killing the earth and all the rest of it so that we don't innovate. Dr. Story Musgrave, storymusgrave.com is our guest. Years ago, I read his autobiography. Story is the name of it. Very powerful. And then, boom, here we are interviewing him. Story, The Way of Water. It is an amazing book. He's also got a book that I haven't read about the P-38 Lightning and what an amazing plane that is. And another one, Australia from Space. He speaks to some of the biggest conferences in the world. Amazing speeches and videos up at his website, storymusgrave.com. In the time we've got left with you in this hour, there's so many points I could raise, so many questions I've got. But when you do give a speech to, say, college students or high school kids or to whoever, I mean, I know you have different speeches, different variants you give of those, but what is the most important overall point? Just the thing about culture and vision and goals and trying to get them to think outside the box. I mean, I love what you're saying about innovation from the bottom up, because that's how I started the interview, because I've read your autobiography, but it makes total sense. This country was the greatest in the world because we were about bottom up and about merit. And I see more and more we're moving towards a system where it's not about merit, it's what group you're a part of via all this political correctness. Story, what's your view on the bottom-up world from somebody who's come from the bottom to the top?
Well, it's the work ethic, and it's passion, and it's creating stuff. It's creating stuff in every day, and it's believing in your company, believing in yourself. Now, what I teach kids is, and I'm massively optimistic for kids, I teach them it's one step at a time. If you look in the mirror today, you say, who am I? What is the total skill set that I got to offer to the world? Now you look at whatever opportunity comes your way. There's a few doors that are open and some that are closed. Well, you look at the doors that are going to open for you and you choose. What's the next mountain I'm going to climb? It's one little step at a time. And see, that's what I've said. As you've repeated, you know, I'm a farm kid, product of child labor. I never finished school. I was a grease monkey, then off the Marines, airframe mechanic, and I just kept rolling. I just kept doing one thing after another, building me a skill set until I could open almost every door there was. And so when you do that, it's just do something. It is do something, do it with heart, do it with passion, be mindful about it so that it adds to the skill set you got. And after a while, you know, you have acquired skills in multiple domains. You're looking at the synergies between the different disciplines you've worked, and that becomes magical. And so I think that's the critical thing. It's whatever you're doing now, do it with excellence. Master that thing so you carry that skill forward.
You talk about that point with life knowledge, life skills, science you've learned, where all the disciplines tie together, and it is magical. And what's sad is so many people you run into are not competent, are not confident, and they really think they have no future when the world is just wide open to them
if they just start moving. Yeah, one step at a time. Take one step. Take one step and do it well. But do not work 8 to 4 in some job you don't like and don't care about and don't give anything to. Because you're not learning anything either. And you're not getting ready for the next mountain.
What was the most beautiful thing, sir, that you ever saw from space?
Well, I got 100 of those things, Alex, but I got to start with the aurora. The aurora traverses over hundreds, if not thousands, of miles. It's pink and it's green, and it shoots up and down. It's almost like you're flying through it. It flows horizontal, and outrageous colors and outrageous motions. And so that's one of the more glorious things. And the moon racing across the ocean, purple lightning that travels horizontal for 100 miles. So the night view is very different, but the day view is fine too. The geography is beautiful. The geography of different countries, and you know, the cloud patterns, the ocean patterns. So the window is spectacular.
I forget the astronaut. We've read the quote before. He was on the moon looking back at the planet Earth and just said that up there it made all the silly fights and all the mindlessness seem so petty.
Yes.
And I've heard a lot of other astronauts say similar things, that if they could just see how small the world was for themselves, it would help people transcend so much of the pettiness.
Yes, sir. Well, I'm not a pessimist, but that stuff didn't work. So Buckminster Fuller said, who was a huge futurist, as you know, he said, you know, once we get beyond ourselves and get out there, and we take a picture of Sagan's little blue marble, from out there, we will be totally different. It will make us think about us all sharing that spaceship. Well, it turns out it was 85. It wasn't a human that took that first picture. It shows Earth, you know, as Earth and as a spaceship. But that didn't change anything, sir. So the pictures from out there did not change anything. Now, you do have the myth about you can't see the borderlines between countries. I can see every one of those because people have different cultural patterns, different building patterns, different agricultural patterns. And so it's very obvious the line.
Sure. I mean, take Hispaniola, which, of course, is Dominican Republic to the east and to the west.
U.S. and Mexico is the sharpest line imaginable. It's a totally sharp line. But now, so that was supposed to change the world, sir. Now, I'm not a pessimist. I'm not a cynic. There's 50 wars today. There are 50 wars. We have our own 6 or 7 now, and we're growing. Our military is entering a lot of other countries this week. But if you add up, there's 50 wars this week on our little spaceship. And we humans need to stop that, because if you look at the amount of resources we put into destroying civilizations as opposed to building them up, it's horrific.
Exactly. And that's why I was going there. The astronauts say that they get this sense once they're out there, but I think the public, just looking at it, it's almost like it's not real. But I tell you, it really hit me this week. I've flown many times around the world, but flying back from Europe on a Dreamliner and seeing the edge of space, you know, seeing the curvature of the Earth, and realizing that I was flying from Rome to the United States in like 10, 11 hours, it made me realize how ridiculous all this is and how silly it is and how finite our resources really are. And if a lot of these robber barons don't allow us to innovate and stifle innovation, I really fear for the future of the species. What is your view, Dr. Musgrave, Story Musgrave, astronaut of astronauts, joining us if you just tuned in? What is your gut view on the future of humanity?
I don't know. I do not know. So, but I know about the concept because Olive Stapleton, in a book called The Star Maker, he was considered to be a science fiction writer, but he was so precise and so detailed that he's considered to be a philosopher. But he, in his imagination and in his science fiction, was able to do star travel. He visited 18 different planets. And he expressed those planets in terms of, did they get their act together or not? So you see what I mean? Did what I call the advanced evolutionary string, that's us. We are what you might call, I don't call us intelligent. We're not intelligent, sir. We're the advanced evolutionary string. If you look at Earth from a billion miles, like Voyager, and you see it as Sagan's pale blue dot, no brighter than a star, and understand that there are 30,000 nuclear bombs in that little lifeboat, you understand we are not intelligent. That is not an intelligent thing to do.
I agree.
So, but we do it, and we continue to do it, and we think it's okay. But Stapleton then, so you get this view from afar that says, is that planet going to get its act together? Is it going to get its act together in terms of all the species getting in balance with each other, taking care of each other, loving themselves, and that's human to human and human to every other creature, insect, and plant there is. Sustainable behavior is the other thing. But we get together and we do a sustainable behavior, and we look after this little spaceship that we have.
And I agree with all that. The problem is some of these corporate interests use all of our goodwill. The sustainability they're setting up doesn't even help the planet. It just gives them more control. I mean, take genetic engineering. It's got a lot of positive things. I mean, you're a medical doctor. You know that. But if you look at the real studies, they're doing it haphazard. It's also got a lot of bad effects, just like a nuclear reactor can be good or bad. And they just don't seem to care. And quite frankly, I don't see us as a species making it much longer. Whether Atlantis was real or not, I call it the Atlantis effect. I think we're rapidly approaching the point where we will basically destroy ourselves or have a catastrophic event that knocks us back into the Stone Age.
Yeah, and so, but we're not responding to all the signs. So it gets down to what socio-political system do we need to have amongst ourselves to manage the globe? And I think, you know, one way to do it is for all of us to buy into a socio-political entity that will be the leader of all countries. The UN was born to help in that regard, but you know what I mean? The UN's been kicked around so bad, I don't even want to use that term. But if all countries could buy into a socio-political enterprise, which would be the leader of the world, and then, you know, and then you build a socio-political system in which people get along and they constructively build civilizations and sustainable behavior. So I guess what the question you're raising is, what is the correct socio-political system to get that job done? So we've gotten rather complicated here, but I know the Austin community can understand.
Sure, and folks all over the world. Well, I want to be specific. If you look at the Rockefellers, if you look at others setting up the League of Nations, setting up the UN, they sold the idea as a League of Nations keeping their sovereignty and freedom but working together. That is a wonderful goal. We obviously need to do that, especially now with nuclear weapons. Great point. The problem is it's been hijacked by multinational corporations that are completely cutthroat, that are monopolistic, and who are cheating, selling weapons while they claim they're trying to stop all of this. And so I think the answer is having a culture from the ground up, based on merit, based on innovation, based on free will, collective ideas. They come from free will, but then they gain, as you said, collectivism. through freedom to have vision so strong, as you said, it can't be denied. And then by our collective decisions, we ignore what the evil sociopaths and psychopaths are doing and the direction they're taking us. I think humanity has abdicated over their duty and has been sucked in by basically the Hollywood culture. And so it is so tunnel visioned or so narcissistic into that, that we're in danger of falling into the water.
Yeah. Well, it's difficult. So, but yeah, it all started out just fine. It was a great idea and it didn't get corrupted.
Let me ask you this question.
What
was the scariest thing you ever saw in space, or the scariest thing that ever happened? I mean, obviously, getting on top one of those rockets, getting on top that space shuttle with three rockets every time is a daredevil event. You did it more than anybody in the U.S. I mean, what was the scariest thing ever happened?
Yeah, it wasn't scary, Alex. It was, I'm a professional, and I make a decision ahead of time. That's what I do in life. But, you know, I was on the only flight to lose an engine after we got off. I had to launch abort before we got off, where he let the engines on the pad and didn't go anywhere. I was on the only shuttle flight to lose a main engine after we got flying. But we had a checklist. We knew where we were going. We had mission control looking after us, so we did what we had to do. I've been very, very fortunate in the aerospace world to have good designers and good machines and good maintenance and good procedures. So I've been in the aerospace world now for 64 years. I soloed 64 years ago. And, you know, I'm very privileged to have great teams looking after me.
Well, you've talked about some of the most beautiful things you saw, and I guess scary was probably the wrong word. I understand you get committed, you know, kind of get in a focused position that you've already made the decision to do this. So I guess I should ask, what was the most dangerous thing? And I think you answered it was when that main engine failed.
Yeah, but that was okay. We almost lost the second one, too. That would have sent us to Spain, to Zaragoza, to land in Zaragoza. But, yeah, so the shuttle was more risk than I like to tolerate. I don't tolerate that amount of risk. So the risk there is about 1 in 50 you're going to get it. And so I don't like that. That's too much for me.
But you did it more than anybody else.
Yeah, but you make the decision, sir. You say it's the only way I can get there and I belong there.
I understand. So, I mean, it's a commitment.
Well, yeah, it's a personal commitment. It's your own.
Well, was it painful for you, obviously? What was the feeling when you saw Challenger explode?
Well, it's you know, first of all, you lost your friends. It goes from grief to anger. That was criminal negligence. So that was not a technological issue. It was criminal negligence. And so it goes from the grief of losing people you knew. And I was on Challenger's first flight.
So I know you were. Story, stay there. We've got a break. We'll come back and talk about that criminal negligence straight ahead. Well, I told you they're killing the space program. I mean, anybody can see that. But Dr. Story Musgrave's been breaking it down from the inside. But don't worry. We've got plenty of banker bailout money to... So Goldman Sachs owners can have literally 300-foot-long yachts at taxpayer expense. It's just ridiculous. And again, I don't like welfare, corporate welfare, but the innovation that comes out of NASA, that's a lot better investment than trillions in banker bailouts. Doctor, finishing up with the Challenger situation, and then I wanted to have you spend a few minutes of what you would do if you were, say, the president. I mean, I guarantee you the president could go out and sell an initiative for a Mars mission. You were just talking about how that's dead. You were talking about 300 Voyagers for the price of one space station. So briefly finish up on Challenger. We want to thank you for joining us. You said you'd come back soon. We look forward to it. And then spend a few minutes on what you would do with the space program if, you know, you were king.
Challenger was just bad decisions. Challenger was micromanaging from people from Washington that didn't know about launch and didn't know the technology. Challenger should have been up to left of the Launch Control Center where they know about launches and they know about technology. You can talk about engineering O-rings, but let's just talk about icicles. That morning, there were a foot and a half long icicles. Okay, you're not certified to launch. You have to look at the requirements you ask a system to perform. Under what conditions will it perform? And so were there any requirements put on a shuttle system that it would fly immersed in ice? There were not. So the system is not designed to fly in ice. And when you see 18-inch-long icicles, you're not certified to fly. And that's a mature decision maker.
That'd be like tying lead weights to the bottom of it.
So you just don't do it. You weren't certified to fly. And so it was micromanagement, you know, and they went ahead and flew anyway, all with all the bad data. Now, what to do next? NASA needs to get visionaries and create a vision that is separate from the administration and separate from the Congress. It needs to be the right thing to do in spaceflight, short-term, middle-term, and long-term. They need to come up with a vision and then insist that the administration and the Congress both together buy into it. Here's the vision. Here's where we want to go. Now, but the administration, this administration, I'm not criticizing them, but they don't believe in space, and space means nothing to them. They don't participate in the space program. They are not there for anything. They don't participate in it, you know. And so the current administration and the Congress is not that passionate or enthusiastic about spaceflight at all. They don't support the team.
I guarantee you, they had like space bonds and all the technology that comes out of it, and they had like comic books for kids and stuff. I could raise, if I had the PR platform, billions and billions a year for NASA. It's so easy. People are in love with space. They know we need to go there. It's being intentionally killed.
They do. The people are behind us. The people support us. Anytime you give them anything. But you do have to give them something. You have to give them space. Now, it was a huge strategic error. Then we went with space station. It's the same price. We could have had 300 Voyager satellites. We could have had satellites on every planet, every moon of every planet, and sample returns from every planet for the cost of space station. You could have had 300 channels. And you could have today, every citizen could have 300 channels in which they select what multimedia they want from what planet or what moon of what planet. We could have covered the solar system with multimedia robots. That's the vision we lost.
Something's going on. We've got to have you back up for part two. StoryMusgrave.com. Story, the book on his website. Story, amazing. You're a true trailblazer, and you're the Americana story from the bottom up. We salute you. Have a great week coming up. We look forward to speaking to you again.
That was terrific, Alex, and thanks so much for bringing me to that great public there.
Thank you, sir. Great to have you.
Okay, best wishes on the journey ahead, everyone.
Thanks for having your daughter on with us. Breaking at Infowars.com, and I got to say, good job to CBS. You know, I got to say this. CBS lies a lot. CBS is globalist. CBS is New World Order. But a lot of big stuff gets broken by CBS. Fast and Furious, you name it. It's kind of like USA Today. Sometimes it's horrible. Sometimes it's good. It's like McClatchy. Sometimes it's like the best there is. Sometimes, you know, it's leftist crud. But I got to say, CBS is one of the few groups that will actually retract BS these days. MSNBC, you can forget it. CNN, you can forget it. NBC, you can forget it. CBS to retract story on Infowars.com. We can now change that headline to they have retracted. They just killed the entire story. There's Kurt Nemo's article. CBS News reports fake story on Infowars. It's like white supremacist militia Infowars has armed men stalking the streets as the police don't know what to do in the face of the Infowars armed commandos. Oh, my gosh. And then it's just made up baloney. And I hope whoever did this. And then they have a video of the Oath Keepers going, we're here to bring everybody together, black, white, old, young. But the property owners, these black businesses that have been looted, it's wrong. And we want to work with everybody. That's our videos. Cut to CBS. It just goes, here are the hateful demons. And they're here for Infowars. And they say they've been paid by Infowars. And then they don't have them saying that. In fact, didn't we download the video? I think we have it. I know we have the story saved. Here's the original story. We'll put it on screen. And then now they have removed it. Which, I'd rather you just remove it and then say this was previously a story that was inaccurate. We took it down. You see, that's not really an apology or a full retraction, but I'll take it. I mean, in the days of, you know, Alex Jones influenced a man who shot three police officers. And then I had to have lawyers call up five newspapers and say, listen, we're going to sue you. We don't want to. We have to. You can't tell cops nationwide that we tell people to kill them. A, we don't agree with that. Just killing random people, anybody. B, the police will end up coming after someone that's doing that. I mean, you're assaulting us with lies. Stop it. You can't say I'm a child molester. You can't say I'm a bank robber. You can't say I'm saying kill cops unless I'm doing it. So they have fully pulled the story. CBS reports fake story on InfoWars hiring militia. I knew about this morning. I hadn't gotten to it really yet because we had Story Musgrave coming on. You heard Story. I was talking to him off air. He's like, yeah, I've heard the show or some videos and your website. I like it. And then he gets on air and goes, hey, you're a listener. He's like, well, I don't, yeah. Because he knows he can probably get in trouble being associated with such incredible evil. And that's all done because they create this perception that, I mean, in that CBS article, it's like these groups are associated with white supremacists. No, we're not. According to the Southern Poverty Law Center, who actually has been caught running the white supremacist compounds. I want to explain something. Not infiltrating them, running them, founding them. Morris Dees was in the South as a lawyer all during the real civil rights movement, and only came back later and set up a movement to milk liberals that truly wanted to end racism. It's a sickening organization. Truly sickening organization. Anybody that listens to this show knows we're the opposite of racist. But I'm so sick of political correctness. Fine, I am. I'm evil. I'm horrible. I'm against aborting any babies. That means I'm racist. Because I believe all lives matter. And he had that Democrat governor apologize and go, I'm sorry, I said all lives matter, you're right. and then forget all the race stuff. Now it's going to be sexist. Bernie Sanders says criticism of Hillary is sexist. You criticize her, you hate women. I mean, that is cult language. That is brainwashing. That is sick. I want to thank God for the gift of consciousness. I just hope I can stay strong and focused so I can give a proper defense of humanity. And I hope you'll join me in that common vision of freedom. Let me finish up with some personal business to the InfoWars operation that affects everybody. It's just the ongoing BS machine. And then we will get into the other news, and our reporters are joining us from Ferguson, the civil emergency situation at the bottom of the hour. The story's on InfoWars.com. CBS News reports fake story on InfoWars hiring militia. They did do a correction, and Rob Dew said it wasn't enough, so they just pulled the entire story. But they know they had to because they show the video of the Oath Keepers, and they don't say InfoWars is paying them. And they're not connected to white supremacists. I mean, it was just a load of bull. And, you know, 15 years ago, the New York Times got caught lying about something. People got fired. Nowadays, what happens when reporters just start writing fiction? I mean, get a job in fiction. I mean, all of us make mistakes, but the Oath Keepers and my reporters aren't parading around in white sheets. They're not out fighting with the black people. They're not connected to white supremacists. And we didn't hire them, and they weren't threatening people. Rob Dew, here's footage of Rob Dew calling the CBS News director. And again, I commend him for taking the story down. It's rare that mainstream media actually retracts stuff these days. So I guess CBS, you could call journalistic. I mean, they got people working for them that put out stuff that's, you know, worthy of a Hollywood script in the fiction department. But that said, I mean, they ought to go to California and, you know, be a better writer than Barton Fink. That said, here's Rob Dew and video and audio of him calling him just about an hour ago.
Hey, is this John?
Yes.
Hey, this is Rob Dew from Infowars.com. You are John Butler, news director for KMOX?
Yes.
Okay. I am looking at a story out of your local, on your local website. Second paragraph down, it says CBS News reported several members of the militia style group called Oath Keepers showed up carrying assault weapons.
Yeah, hold on. Let me bring it up.
Sure. The headline's militia style group hired to protect reporters in Ferguson.
Whoa. Okay. There we go. We've got it.
Okay.
All right. Now, military style group hired to protect Ferguson reporters.
Right. Okay. Yeah, it's worded a little differently on your website. But second paragraph down, it says they were hired by Infowars.com, a website run by Alex Jones, to protect its reporters.
Right.
Okay. That is patently false.
Oh, is it?
Yes. It is patently false. So I just got off the phone with the reporters that I sent. I'm Rob Dew, the news director here at Infowars.com and Infowars Nightly News. And so we've been getting a lot of phone calls from other places asking us, checking on the source, asking us, saying, is this true? Is this true? And we have denied it. The Oath Keepers were there protecting local businesses.
Right.
And they offered to walk with us. And so our guy said, sure, y'all can walk with us. But there was no hiring going on at all.
Okay. Well, I get that. All right. We'll definitely change it.
Okay. And when let me give you my email. Can you send me the new link whenever you guys retract that?
Yeah. How about if you send me an email?
Okay.
It's easy. It's J.M.
Butler at CBS.
Butler at CBS.com.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Hey, I appreciate you working with us. Thank you. We did not hire them. Correct.
They offered to walk with you.
Yes. They offered to us. And
you said sure.
We said sure. Because, I mean, if you look at there's a post-dispatch reporter in the hospital right now recovering with a concussion.
Oh, believe me. Yeah. You know, I had two people on the street that night. I absolutely understand.
Right.
All righty. We'll fix it.
Okay. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. Those videos are up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. And I got to say, that's a good news director right there. There's a mistake. They fixed it. Good job to CBS News. There, but we just have to continue to counter this type of stuff when it happens. The bad part about the article is trying to mix it all in with white supremacists, and because the Southern Poverty Law Center says the Southern Poverty Law Center can say the moon was made of cheese. Doesn't mean you have to run with it. These people are known liars. They make Obama look truthful. They work for the Clintons, for heaven's sakes. Sick of these people. I've got to get Joseph Farah back on to find out the latest. They did a four-year suit and got from the Clinton library thousands of pages of the secret documents from 1993 when they got in and were trying to shut down the Western Journalism Center. That's WorldNet Daily, its previous incarnation, and saying if the internet ever starts having alternative news, we're done. We've got to use the word conspiracy theory. We've got to have the IRS go after people. You know, we've got to demonize them, connect them to racism, whatever. And it's all there cold-bloodedly saying, we can't allow free thought. And then here we are all these years later. What do? Don't go to InfoWars, it gives you viruses, totally made up. Don't go to Drudge, it gives you viruses, totally made up. Don't go to InfoWars, it's racist, totally made up. That's the group tied into the Boston bombing. I mean, it's just incredible the stuff these people engage in because they're scared. And speaking of Hillary, I already mentioned this, but I'm going to get back into this before I get back into Ferguson. Bernie Sanders, a guy that can't do basic arithmetic, we're totally bankrupt. We have the biggest welfare state in history. The ultra-rich are basically tax-exempt. He never talks about that. He talks about higher taxes on the ultra-rich, something Warren Buffett wants, but they never do it. They end up doing it on the middle class to shut down any real economy. And now Bernie Sanders is running around. I've got the full quotes here from CNN. There's video of it saying, criticism of Hillary is sexist. And basically saying she's a good person. I mean, she's the ultimate fat cat, worth over $100 million, was worth nothing when she got in office. She takes money from dictators. I was talking to a pretty prominent Democrat in Texas a few weeks ago before I left town. And I said, why is it they're indicting all these Republicans for stuff that probably isn't even illegal? It's questionable, but not illegal. But then Hillary can take money from third world dictators at the State Department to remove the export ban on weapons. That's a clear bribe. And he goes, you forgot the Democrat rule, and giggled. I mean, these people are allowed to do whatever they want. And now Bernie Sanders is saying, quote, I think, let me do his voice, I think for a variety of reasons, Hillary Clinton has been under all kinds of attack for many, many years. In fact, I can't think of many personalities who've been attacked for more reasons than Hillary Clinton. And by the way, let me be frank, and I'm running against her. Some of it's sexist. Sanders, the Vermont senator, said Sunday in an interview with CBS Face the Nation. I don't know that a man would be treated the same way that Hillary is, Sanders said. So all that I can say is that I have known Hillary for 25 years. I admire her. I respect her. I like her. She and I have very different points of view on a number of issues. That's a pretty good imitation of him. I mean, you can tell Bernie Sanders is as dumb as a pile of steaming dog crap. Oh, I'm so sick of these people, these pseudo-intellectuals with their moron followers. I've seen Bernie Sanders' followers in interviews. These people have lower IQs than drying paint. They're the people that go out and sign Mark Dice petitions 8-2 is the average, 80%. Let's put gun owners in slave camps and kill them. Yes, I want to put them in slave camps. Let's take the Bill of Rights and arrest anyone that criticizes Hillary. Oh, yeah, I'm sick of folks talking bad about her. Let's arrest them. I mean, these people are dangerous, would-be Mao Zedongs, and they can go to hell. And I'm sorry to use that type of language, but, man, when it fits, I got a big lexicon, a big repertoire. I have a very large semantical dictionary, thesaurus. I have a good handle on the English language. And I've got a lot of words to describe these people. But sometimes the guttural Anglo-Saxon is the only way to describe these people. They are full of you-know-what. Bravo, Sierra is their planet. Can you imagine a planet with nothing but parasites? Planet vampire. But there wouldn't be any vampires because there's nobody to suck off of if it's only them. And all these stupid people that don't know that free market gives you so much wealth, you turn into big, fat, spoiled brats, and the society collapses. So there is a problem with it. But, I mean, socialism and communism creates hellish nightmares. And so now if you criticize Hillary for Hillary care and trying to take our guns and trying to ban the name boy and girl and opening the borders and Benghazi and Fast and Furious and persecuting people, the IRS, you're healthy. Sexist. Look at this headline.
She lost both of her babies in the
Sanders pulls crowd of 27,000 in L.A. That's what I mean, just idiots. He's gotten the teachers union endorsement. They want some free goodies. There's so many good teachers out there, but man... You just can't get more for nothing. The country's bankrupt. Why huge Los Angeles crowd turned out for Bernie Sanders? Bernie Sanders scores a nurses union endorsement. Oh, but don't worry. Hillary Clinton is now defending Megyn Kelly and says that she's incredibly impressive. Megyn, she wants to invite you to the Lincoln bedroom. You really want to join the cult, Megan? Hillary likes you. And I mean, I'm not being sexist here. Hillary likes women. She loves blondes. It's well known. And she says she likes you. So be incredibly impressive. Report on the fact that the blonde Janet Reno likes you. Oh, boy. Hillary's like, hey, Toots, how you doing? You look pretty good, Megan. I like how you're energizing the whole feminist thing, making it all about how I got Bernie over there working for me, too. I got a lot of girls work for me. Give me a cigar, Mac. You want to go far in this business, Megan? Get over here to the Lincoln bedroom so we can play Pachisi. Oh, my gosh. Back to Bernie Sanders. He's had 70,000 people in the last 3 days cheering him in California. Rapper has dropped Clinton for Sanders. Oh, my gosh. Homie Macker has now endorsed her. California rapper Brandon McCartney. Well, that's really important. CNN. But don't worry. Back to the other diversion. Megyn Kelly says she won't be cowed by Donald Trump. Oh, my gosh. She's such a champion. Trump's momentum keeps rolling the hill. Polls keep going up. Ted Cruz says it's foolish for GOP to criticize Trump, pointing out that he's putting out a lot of ideas that they agree with, so don't fall into the trap. I agree with it. Texas Senator Ted Cruz on Monday warned that Republican presidential candidates who are slamming Donald Trump do so at their political peril. Cruz's remarks, which came during an interview with Politico, said he swings through the South on a bus tour are among the most detailed comments to date regarding his reluctance to criticize the real estate mogul who is currently leading the polls in the GOP. I would note, quoting Cruz, that a lot of Republicans, including other Republican candidates, have gone out of their way to smack Donald Trump with a stick. Now, I think that's just foolish. And he goes on, asked why Cruz paused and replied, Donald Trump at a rally in Phoenix, between 10,000 to 20,000 people came out. When you attack and vilify the people at a rally as crazies, it does nothing to help Republicans win 2016. And he goes on from there. Yeah, he's meant to cause a civil war in the Republican Party. And he said he's getting ready to run third party, probably. I just want to ask, why aren't Republicans talking like him? You would have never given him the space to do this. But all the Republican advisors say don't do it, so Trump can then go do it and set your butt up. And I've been saying that since day one. Oh, it's unbelievable. Truly unbelievable. We've got our reporters coming up from Ferguson. It's a crazy situation there with people getting shot and businesses being looted and other issues. We put out a video about unity and the Oath Keepers calling for unity and trying to educate folks on the ground about how divide and conquer works and George Soros and protecting black businesses. It's mainly black businesses have been getting burned. And CBS News puts out a report about white supremacists, Oath Keepers, and InfoWars with no evidence of white supremacists, just to demonize the whole thing. But they've since retracted it. Meanwhile, Missouri representative, we have the video of this coming up, says take out the Oath Keepers. Take them out. Calls them instigators because they're there guarding businesses. Were the Korean shop owners instigators in the South Central LA riot of 20 years ago? 20 plus years ago? It's all coming up. Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.tv, and news from Europe as well. Coming up, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to look at the de-evolution of humanity by technocratic design. Two articles from the Daily Mail and the London Independent tie together on this front. Not going out. Why millennials are no longer going to nightclubs. And another headline, Generation Fail. Social media addicts are more likely to feel inadequate when it comes to their careers and looks. You know, some of God's greatest gifts, to quote Garth Brooks, are unanswered prayers. In fact, remind me to do this. I'm going to tell a story concerning this of when I was in Rome inside the Vatican after our guests leave and how it's an allegory to some of God's greatest gifts or unanswered prayers. But that ties together. We've got news out of Europe, economic news, and a lot more we're going to be hitting. Emergency has been declared as of yesterday in Ferguson after shooting of Michael Brown's friend, who police say shot at them. Again, I'm not somebody that mindlessly sides with the police, but when you got George Soros financing all this, when you've got all the witnesses that were black saying the opposite of what Michael Brown's friend who got shot said, generally the police have been telling the truth a lot more than the violent demonstrators who are even looting black shops. Does that mean there aren't cops executing people in cold blood across the country? Does that mean they don't get away with it sometimes? Absolutely, it's happening. Is it the number one issue in America? Or the twin issue of Donald Trump or Black Lives Matter? Yeah, I think all Black Lives Matter. I think all lives matter. I mean, you know my drill. It's the truth. 52%, 51%, depending on the numbers of blacks, are never born. We're talking like 16, 17 million people versus a couple thousand black men killed questionably in the last 20 years. Look, it's 100 or so a year that are questionable shootings by the cops. It's over 1,000 whites in questionable shootings. And if you look at the numbers, it's about the same. Maybe a little more whites per capita than blacks getting shot by cops. And it's not racial most of the time, but if it is some of the time, is it the only issue in the world? No. They want to divert us down this rabbit trail while they're geoengineering and the borders are open and the economy's collapsing and they're gearing up martial law. And I heard that video from a month and a half ago, total emergency alert, elite now evacuating. I'm going to do an update on that in the next few days because that's only accelerated. I'm not saying something big's happening. They say it, and I hope it's a false alarm. I hope it's just a drill. But, man, I'm telling you, the whole world isn't Donald Trump. If the mainstream media didn't like Donald Trump, they would have ignored him day one. They want to build him up, whether he's a good guy or a bad guy. And it's the same thing with this whole George Soros situation. George Soros overthrows countries from Africa to Europe, from Asia to the Middle East all the time. He's been doing it for 30 years, devaluing currencies, bringing in riots. And during an economic collapse, you bet your bottom dollar, they're going to activate race war in this country if they get away with it. Remember, there's not just bad guys in this world. There's good people, too. And so I'm going to try to support good police. I'm going to try to promote local policing. I'm going to try to promote a good culture and support good police, go after bad cops. But I'm not going to ever be part of a thing of kill the pigs and the cops are bad and blah, blah, blah. The laws are what are wrong, or the interpretation of them is what's wrong. I'm ranting. We're going to go to Jakari Jackson and Joe Biggs right now. Reporting as a great team. They've both been pepper sprayed, rubber bulleted in the case of Biggs, along with Al Jazeera and others, and when the police were out of control and ordered to target the media. Again, we're not saying they're perfect. They're certainly out of control and shameful and stupid and mindless, and that's what happens in a mob situation. Both sides degenerate, and that's why Soros wants to bring this in. But we'll see what's happened since they got there yesterday. We've already had CBS News retract trying to tie Jakari and Biggs and Oath Keepers. You know, they're all in the same article, in with white supremacists. There's no white supremacists there. There's no connection. And into that, we're hiring the Oath Keepers to intimidate people. They have removed the article. We have screenshots of it at Infowars.com right now. It's red-linked, and it's not just because it's about us. It just shows how they manipulate stories. CBS News reports fake story on Infowars. Hiring militia. Joining us is Joe Biggs. I think he's first up on camera. Then we'll get Jakari's take. Joe, you've heard my little rant there. Fill in the blanks.
All right, Joe Biggs here with Infowars.com. We're currently standing on South Florissant Avenue right across from the fire department and police station. If you guys remember back last November, this is the exact location where Jakari Jackson and I were standing when the no indictment came out and the killing of Michael Brown with Officer Darren Wilson. Now things have began to heat up again a year later on the anniversary of Michael Brown's killing. And a lot of people have taken to the street and began some peaceful protests. Sunday night, there were peaceful protests mostly throughout the entire day, but a few things erupted. Some people were arrested. A business was broken into. A man was shot. And a couple of reporters were beaten up. So last night, we found out that we'd be coming into town. I actually reached out. I contacted some of the Oath Keepers like I do whenever I go to a different state. And I just try to get a point of view, information from boots on the ground, from people who live there, because it's a lot easier to talk to someone that we already have a rapport with versus just randomly stopping and asking somebody what's going on. So I asked the guys, what's the situation in Ferguson? What's the attitude like? What's going on? And they just said, you know, things have been heated up really well. We were asked to go and guard some of these different businesses. Now, over here to my right, your left, is where are some of the small businesses were that black owners have. And they contacted the Oath Keepers last year, and they stood guard. The Oath Keepers stood guard and protected these businesses from looters and riots. So they already have a good rapport. So they contacted BBAC and said, hey, I've got a small five-man team, including myself. We'd like to come out, if you wouldn't mind, and pull some security so you and Jakari have the ability to rapport without having to worry about anybody running up behind you, hitting you over the head, kicking you to the ground, and stomping on
that
you.
That was very nice of them. I want to thank them for that.
Yeah, like I said, we never hired them. We never exchanged any kind of currency, anything like that. They offered their help. They volunteered to be there and support us because they support what we do. And the guys, literally, one of the quotes last night was, he's like, hey, Jakari Jackson and Joe, you guys are some of the real, you know, last good reporters. We want to keep you guys alive as long as possible to continue reporting on these events so people can find out the truth about what's really going on. So that's why we're out here. We want to expose what's going on. We know that there's a lot of police corruption going on. You know, the fact that these body cameras get sent back to the police stations for only these police officers to then judge themselves. I actually spoke to a gentleman last night, one of the protesters, says, why doesn't the footage go to a non-biased source, someone who can watch that footage and then use that to go into court if something does happen, instead of that footage from the body cams just going directly to the police force and those guys going, we're not going to release that or it's not going to come out.
Well, I agree. The fact that they waited on Brown so long is what helped build all this up. It almost seemed like somebody wanted to stir things up. Or do you think the people in charge are just that ignorant?
I think they're just that ignorant. I mean, that's what Jakari was and I were talking about earlier. The fact that a lot of these community leaders in St. Louis don't really do what they need to do to take care of stuff. Now, we saw in other situations like in Charleston, South Carolina, and Cleveland and Cincinnati, when the community came together, the leaders, the politicians who are there supposed to help out the civilians in that area, when they came together and they did the right thing, nothing happened. It was cool, calm, and collective. There were no riots. There was nothing. A horrendous crime was committed in Charleston, South Carolina, and the community came together. They pulled together. But you don't see that here in Ferguson that much.
Joe, I want to get Jakari's take on the situation here and, you know, flip around and get him in front of the camera there. But specifically, what is it like under the emergency that's declared? And we're now hearing the police chief is saying they're talking to the, quote, demonstrators and locals about what they think the role of the armed men is and should guns be allowed during a civil emergency. So if they say no guns during a civil emergency, what a precedent outside of law. You need guns during the breakdown of society in the emergency. All common sense shows that. So a very chilling statement.
Well, last night was very interesting. When we first walked out, we approached West Florissant Avenue. We got out, and everybody saw us. And a lot of people at the beginning were kind of upset because they didn't know who it was. They just saw a group of five guys with guns and two people walking in the middle of them. Once we got across the street, the police officer stopped us, said, please don't walk behind us with your guns. We said, okay, that's fine. We walked in front of them down the sidewalk towards the Quick Trip. We made a left, went back over to the Sam's Meat Market where those gentlemen have in times past came out with guns and protected their business. And then we began to walk back towards the McDonald's on West Florissant. A lot of people jumped out and said, what the hell are you guys doing out here? Why do you have guns? And there was a number of people who came out and said, hey, that's InfoWars. These guys are good. They tell the truth. And another lady came out of the crowd and went over to Sam, one of the Oath Keepers, and said, hey, this guy has been helping protect black businesses. These guys are good people. Leave them alone. Let them do their job. So you get a lot of people that come out here and spread, you know, disinformation, all these lies and this BS.
Well, exactly. Here's what's happening, Joe. Well, that horn's going off. We'll fade it down and I'll talk for a moment. But expanding on that, they're trying to take our guns. They have a program to demonize the ownership of guns. They admitted to the Justice Department. The word is brainwash. You know, the compound word is brainwash. There's a directive. And so we exercise the Second Amendment openly to counter that and say guns aren't illegal. And the answer is good people of every race, color, and creed with guns scares off the bad people. Bad people are going to have them hidden and pull it out on you when you don't know what's happening, when you don't know what's going on. And so that's why they're pushing this. That's why they want to demonize the Oath Keepers who've never been involved in crime, never been involved in anything racist, are just supporting the Bill of Rights and Constitution. And Stuart Rhodes and others, you know, one of Ron Paul's former staff members that founded it, frequent guest here, are simply saying clearly the elite are getting ready for a collapse. It could be imminent. We need to get ourselves squared away and get ready to maintain security during the collapse of society. And what is the black sheriff of Milwaukee saying? Same thing. And he's a member of Sheriff Mack's group. What is the black police chief of Detroit saying? Buy guns to protect yourself. They're getting rid of the police force, basically. And cops, the head of Interpol, a black guy again. I don't know why it's black guy to our police chief saying this, saying we should arm people to stop mass shootings. It's common sense. It's not racist. It doesn't work anymore. Let's see if that horn's still going off there in Ferguson, Missouri, with Joe Biggs joining us via video link. Go ahead.
Well, last night we were able to actually engage in a really good conversation. Like I said at the beginning, a lot of people were kind of just concerned. They're like, all right, what's going on? But then once people saw who we were, everyone calmed down. They came over. We crossed the street again. And people came over and they asked us, you know, why would you do this? And some people didn't even know that they were able to do that in their own state that they live in. So it was an opportunity to speak to people about the Second Amendment, your rights to be able to carry guns. You know, a lot of people didn't even know the facts behind it, you know, that if you don't have a felony and you're not under the influence of alcohol or drugs, that you can carry a long gun
that's
or you can
point.
Carry a shotgun. You know, but that's the thing, that people don't know that. And they were completely shocked. They said, well, if you guys can carry them, why can't I carry them? And Jakari, at one point, I remember, he looked at the guy, he said, no one told you you couldn't carry a gun. You have that right. It's your ability. You just need to go out, learn the laws, understand what it is that you need to do to be able to do that, and you can exercise your Second Amendment peacefully.
That's right. And look, what you're doing is bold. What you're doing is dangerous. It's one of the ultimate civil rights, human rights movements for open carry. They say it's against the law to open carry rifles in San Antonio, violate state law. We marched with the Texas Land Commissioner for the first political speech at Alamo history, because they didn't allow speeches after it was destroyed. And the state took it over from the Daughters of the Republic of Texas. And we gave a speech. 1,500 people of every race, color, and creed. And now they're changing the law in San Antonio. So we're taking our rights back. Just 20 years ago, driving around Austin, every 10th pickup truck had a 243 or a 308 deer rifle in it. Well, cops started harassing people under orders by politically correct police chiefs. So people are putting their guns back in their gun racks. And if a cop harasses you, we're not anti-police, but we're pro-America. We're going to sue you. We're going to sue the police department until they stop giving you illegal orders. This is a movement. We're not backing off. We're not backing down. We're going to come back and talk to Jakari Jackson. I'm going to do 30 minutes of overdrive today because I got here late because of a family issue and a story I was on. I'm going to come back to Jakari Jackson and then come back to Joe Biggs if he wants to come back. I got other news I'm going to hit. Some stations don't carry the fourth hour. In the next few months, we're going to be going back to the fourth hour, always being live. I'll be hosting it with a round table with my reporters every day and special magazine-type reports and documentaries. The fourth hour is going to become the best hour of the show for stations out there that want to start picking it up again. But in the meantime, Infowars.com/show. You go there, the free video feed, free podcast, audio feeds, iPhone apps, Droid apps, it's all free, Infowars.com/show. Imagine the power of you, of we, the people, sending that link on Facebook, Twitter, sharing it with friends and family. That's why you look at the graphs. We'll do a story on this. Our audio streams, podcasts, and video viewers, just on our own native systems, is exponentially going up. And I'm getting cheaper and cheaper bandwidth. The IT folks come in and say, we got the cheapest bandwidth there is. It's $40,000 this month. Do you really want to keep supplying millions of people a day to the podcast, the video feeds? And I go, yes, I will get the funds. We've got to have our own system as censorship increase. And it costs a lot. Closed captioning to launch the TV network. Just 4 hours a day to be closed captioned by a real person. Federal law, $10,500 a month. The satellite, $15,000 a month. Other contracts, you're talking like 30-something grand a month just for that. We are committing. We're putting literally 95% of the money that comes into here right back into the operation. The rest we're war chesting for backup. We've only got about a 4 or 5 month backup as our emergency war chest. I don't want to spend that, but I'm committed to go to the next level. I will. Go to InfoWarsStore.com. I didn't even plug last hour. So when you hear me plug, support us. I want to thank you for that. The highest quality water filters, lowest prices, non-GMO seeds, videos, books, shortwave radios, hundreds of items, cook stoves, just hundreds of items. It's all there. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. A lot of the products that were sold out, like Prostaguard, Knockout, are back in. We have Super Male Vitality finally back in, the strongest Male Vitality product out there. It'll just blow you away. A five-star review, something like 98% review, thousands of reviews, InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. You're funding the tip of the spear and the fight for humanity. We salute you all. We'll be right back. Ja'Kari Jackson's our guest. I'm doing 30 minutes live in overdrive so I can get into the brainwashing that's taking place and the loss of humanity that's unfolding and how TV head behavior, social media head behavior, is basically turning young people into zombies. I'm going to get into a lot of other news as well. I'll get into that allegory, tying into the fact that some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. I'll do that at 8 after next hour. Ja'Kari Jackson joining us from Ferguson, Missouri. Ja'Kari, you're brave again to be back out there. I'm glad you guys wanted to go. What is your take on your observations since you got there yesterday afternoon?
Ja'Kari Jackson reporting from Ferguson, Missouri. Now, Alex, as I always talk about Ferguson, Missouri, people see all the craziness and the things that happen on TV. And yes, that stuff does happen. I just want to reassure the viewers that the majority of the people out here are peaceful. They are, you know, nice, gentle people. They may go out into the crowds and protest, but they do so peacefully. What you see on TV is a violent minority. With that said, we've seen the reports of reporters being attacked, people being put into the hospital and all that. And also, if you guys recall last November when myself and Joe Biggs were here, we were talking to a reporter about this just a little bit ago. Firefighters were being attacked. They had people shooting at them. And even though there was a SWAT team 200 yards away, they didn't come down and help the firefighters. The firefighters had to leave. So with that in mind, we said, well, we don't want to wait for somebody to come and maybe protect us. We wanted to be able to protect ourselves. So the Oath Keepers so graciously came out and shadow us around, provided us with security as we moved about. Once again, we did not hire them. We did not exchange any type of funds, bitcoins, or anything else. They came out here and just wanted to help us as we were reporting on the activities of the day. And to anybody who says they were out here fear-mongering and bullying people, you can see the videos on InfoWars.com. At one point, the conversation between the Oath Keepers and the public got so relaxed, they started talking about taxes.
You know, to and me, that's that what scares CBS News and why they try to bring in white supremacist stuff in the article when there was none of that going on, is they imagine demonstrators get along with armed vigilantes. I mean, that would be their headline. That's a sensational headline. That's the truth. So you guys should shoot a video with your original video, Ja'Kari, and point that out, that demonstrators in Ferguson embrace armed citizens. I mean, that's true. It's what happened. But you wouldn't believe that with CBS following orders from the Southern Poverty Law Center.
And that's the thing. We talked about this a little bit ago. You know, myself, Joe Biggs, many of the Oath Keepers talked to many news outlets, also people with just iPhones or whatever, and they asked, are you guys being paid? We told everybody, no, these guys are not being paid. But somehow it still wound up on CBS that we were paying these guys off, even though that's 100% not true. You guys can go watch Rob Dew's report about it when he talked to, I guess it was their news director over there at CBS. But the situation right now, Alex, is very peaceful. It's very calm. Maybe we can pan around and show people that this is the police station where last year we were out here for the indictment or the no indictment, and then a little bit of chaos broke out after that. So it's largely calm right now, and hopefully it will stay that way, Alex.
Ja'Kari, I kind of let you guys run things on your own because obviously you're the eyes and ears on the ground. What do you expect to happen tonight? Are things being diffused with a state of emergency? You planning to stay? What do you expect?
Well, we'll definitely be back out here tonight. As far as when we got here, we got off the plane a little bit late. We had some delays. But when we got here, things were largely quiet. Yeah, there are crowds out there, but, you know, no hubbub, no rocks being thrown that I saw, no frozen water bottles. All that stuff had happened at an earlier time. So, you know, the police were out there. They just said, please don't walk in front of us with your firearms. We didn't do that, and we didn't have any issues.
Well, good job, just like you did in San Antonio, out there with that open carry, Ja'Kari. Tip of the spear, InfoWars.com. Thank you so much. Be safe out there tonight. And I guess you guys are probably planning to come home Thursday?
Later sometime this week. We haven't set a firm date
good,
yet.
Good, good. Yeah, obviously, we hope you get to come back soon. We hope things get de-escalated. We'll be right back in overdrive. Some stations don't carry it. InfoWars.com/show. Support our local affiliates. Spread the word. Communications. The globalist. We are now into the fourth hour of overdrive. Thank you so much for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. I'm your host, Alex Jones. I want to shift gears into some of the other news that we've not covered yet that we've not gotten into in the next 30 minutes here. And believe me, there is a lot of it. If you basically look at what's happening with the political field, Bernie Sanders, an avowed communist, basically, is running around promising government workers even higher pensions and pay if they just have wealth redistribution, which, of course, doesn't work. And then they demonize capitalism by claiming what we have is capitalism when we don't. 27,000 people in L.A., 70,000 in his last three stops total. Eye-popping West Coast swing, reading DrudgeReport.com headlines. Sanders scores National Nurses Union statement. O'Malley raises legal question with debate plan. Hillary defends incredibly impressive Megyn Kelly. Can we get that disgusting video, guys? Thanks. Megyn says no fear or favor for Trump when Trump's done nothing to her. And Bernie Sanders says it's sexist to criticize Hillary and that she's a wonderful person. Truly disgusting. So helping set the precedent that criticizing the witch, Hillary, the criminal Hillary, is because she's a woman. I mean, this is identity politics with this cult, this religion of fruitcakes. Trump is expanding his poll numbers in many polls, maintaining his lead in Iowa and other states. As I mentioned, Cruz says it's foolish for GOP to criticize. Kasich and Carly rise in New Hampshire. Carson and Rubio jump in Iowa. Four GOPers beating Hillary in Corn State. Nancy Reagan invites 16 candidates to the CNN debate. We do have Hillary Clinton salivating over Megyn Kelly. Here it is.
It was offensive. I said it was outrageous. I stand by that. I think more people should say the same. They should be going after him. The Republican Party is going to have to deal with him. But I just want to remind us that what they say about women, not one woman who is perfectly capable and incredibly impressive, able to take care of herself, but all these women that I have fought for, worked for, stood up for, advocated for, and want to be a president for, who may not have the opportunity to defend themselves, who may lose the right to exercise a personal choice if certain of the Republicans were to be successful. I don't want that forgotten. So yes, I know it makes great TV. I think the guy went way overboard, offensive, outrageous, pick your adjective. But what Marco Rubio said has as much of an impact in terms of where the Republican Party is today as anybody else on that stage. And it is deeply troubling, and it should be.
There's no doubt Hillary's got a crush on Megyn Kelly, and that's okay. I'm a libertarian. You know, the fact that Hillary reportedly has had more sexual partners than Bill, most of them women, yeah, I think she should be proud of the fact that she's clearly got a crush on Hillary. I mean, on Megyn. Now, I mean, let me cut the sarcasm here. When we come back, I'll tell you what I really think about Megyn Kelly, Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, and the rest of it. And then I'm going to shift into what I mentioned earlier. Not going out. Why millennials are no longer going to nightclubs. See, millennials don't go out and go to nightclubs. And Hillary, she didn't have to go out either. She's got the Lincoln bedroom. And then we've got a generation failed. Social media addicts are more likely to feel inadequate when it comes to their careers and looks. That ties into the dehumanization. Stay with us. You know who Hillary's got on her pin up on her wall. Look at this story from Americans for Tax Reform. This illustrates everything we're talking about and the globalist model perfectly. This one article, Americans for Tax Reform article up on DrudgeReport.com. Guys, I want to post this entire article at InfoWars.com. Lowest learners, IRS granted only one conservative group nonprofit status in 3 years. You want to know the power to destroy, the power to control ideas? You create a tax-exempt system for religious, political groups, and others. And then you tell religious groups you can't be political. When the First Amendment says you already have tax exemption because Congress should make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, then it goes on to the press and the right of assembly and the right of petition. That's the First Amendment to the Bill of Rights, and it's the first for a reason. So they've inverted or they've twisted, they've made upside down how this is supposed to work. And so this is the latest study. The truth is, in the 7 years or 6.5 years of Obama, they've only given out a handful of thousands of tax exemptions, and only three. Lois Lerner's IRS granted one conservative group nonprofit status in 3 years. Now, I've thought about creating a nonprofit division of InfoWars because we could do so much more if we did and have it serve the founding principles of the Republic. And be a pro-human foundation, an anti-eugenics foundation, and then have a think tank, reporters that put out reports, so that I could have reporters that could then report to InfoWars, and we could have more reporters and finance what we're doing and get more of the word out. There is no way in Hades, we've looked into it, that the IRS would ever issue that. But I've made the decision, and I'm telling my accountants today, they're coming to meet me after the show. In fact, I'm doing overdrive. They're waiting right now that I'm going to seek a tax-exempt status, not for InfoWars, but for a new Bill of Rights-promoting foundation. And you watch, these dirtbags are going to refuse it, and I'm going to sue them. Thousands of groups have had it revoked, and only one group in 3 years has been given tax exemption. You're supposed to just get it. Libertarian, conservative, veterans groups, gun groups are all being refused or having them revoked. And then they say, guess what? You owe back taxes. We're saying the last 2 years you weren't really exempt. So for all your operations and your people, you know, lobbying on Capitol Hill for the Second Amendment, whatever it is, you owe the IRS money. Open, naked persecution. But it gets worse. I remember this headline. It was in the Washington Post 6 months ago. Not one liberal group has been refused. Over 10,000 were issued. Let's see how good my memory is. I just remembered that. Guys, search not one liberal group refused tax exemption by Lerner. And if memory serves, it was like 10,000 that Obama's given. 10,000 groups get to be tax exempt. One conservative group gets to be tax exempt. 10,000 to one. We know David could beat one Goliath, who was five times his size. Could he beat 10,000? Not even Samson could do that. This is how they operate selectively. Warren Buffett, Ted Turner, Bill Gates, General Electric, Google. They're all tax exempt. Their employees pay taxes, but not them. They're all multinational. There it is. IRS-approved liberal groups while Tea Party in limbo. That's an article out of USA Today. I don't know if that's the same one, but you can look it up. Not one liberal group refused tax-exempt status. That's the headline. So they all get it, but nobody else does if you're not a commie, basically. And see, McDonald's got waivers on Obamacare. Don't have to get Obamacare for their full-time employees, so they didn't have to get rid of their full-time employees. Everybody else did, putting them at a disadvantage. And thousands of Democratic Party groups, they got exemptions from Obamacare. See, they create these laws to then selectively enforce it, and that's where the real fraud is. Lois Lerner refused tax-exempt status to hundreds of conservative groups, but granted status to an underage prostitution ring. Now, there's a Gateway Pundit article. We'll find it. I remember the headline. It was, no liberal groups refuse tax-exempt charitable status. I remember that headline emblazoned on my brain. But we're finding lots of other interesting stuff while we look for it, which just keeps backing up what I'm saying. But one group in 3 years, thousands and thousands and thousands, NAMBLA is tax exempt. But a group promoting the Second Amendment? No, no, no. This is how they want to shut down speech in this country. And there's no jurisdiction for the government to be involved. That's why I opposed the Texas film initiative where they were giving tax exemption. Because if you wanted to do a pro-gun film or a film about Waco or a film that was anti-GMO, even liberal, they wouldn't give you the tax exemption. They had a little private board in Austin tied into the Austin Film Society, and then who's now taken over Access Television, by the way. And they would decide and selectively, like indulgences, or you know, like the old Soviet Union would decide who could have a show, who could have a program, who could be involved, who could have a play. No, if you're gonna have tax exemption, you fill out the form, and then if you make a film in this state, you get tax exemption. I'm all for that. But you don't get to say what the project is. And so they had national headlines that Alex Jones kills film in Texas. No, the people politicizing the tax exemption and selectively using it, you're the ones that crapped all over it, not me. And I have a lot of friends, you know, in the whole Austin film scene and on the Film Society, a lot of good people. But Robert Rodriguez ruined the whole thing. And I'll tell you, he's the David Duke of Hispanics. Truly disgusting. And I know he hates my guts. I knew that 15 years ago. And now I've heard what he's turned into and hanging out with Obama, and it's frightening. It's frightening. I've talked to folks that work for him. He will not hire anybody at his TV, his new TV network, that isn't Hispanic. And I think that's terrible. I mean, we hire anybody to get the job done. I don't care what color you are. You can get the job done, I'll hire you. I don't mean to go off on a jag about Robert Rodriguez. It's just they want racial politics. That's how they want this whole thing to operate. I'm going to come back in the next segment with the whole parallel, the allegory that ties into some of God's greatest gifts or unanswered prayers. And then we're going to put this audio together for the nightly news with the video we shot in Rome that ties into it. But before we go any further, two articles, not going out, why millennials are no longer going to nightclubs. And before I read it, I knew it would be social media and wanting to stay home and wanting to talk to people on Facebook and wanting to just listen to music alone and not associate with other humans. And you read the article, that's what it says. And then there's another one right here, because all the data's there. I'm not bragging that I knew what was in the article before I read it. It's just a fact. Daily Mail, generation hashtag fail, social media addicts are more likely to feel inadequate when it comes to their careers and looks. They make less money. They know less people. It's fine to use Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube to educate other people, to reach out to others, to share your art, to magnify what's happening in the third dimension, not in the digital silicon dimension. You take the real world and you magnify it in cyber. That's my philosophy, because we're immersed in it. And that empowers, and then it's a good tool. It's like using a gun to, you know, get some games. You don't starve to death. But if people that only immerse themselves in the false reality of Second Life, where they spend real money to buy a, you know, an imaginary Ferrari, and where they're movie stars, in the real world they're not movie stars, so they don't feel adequate. You have to go out in the real world and just go through the experience, and it's the experience that is the destination. The journey is the ultimate destination, as they've said many times. Survey found 56% of social media users feel they're not reaching potential. It found people feel like they're underperforming in four main ways. These include body image, career, mood, and energy levels. One-third of young men wish they were closely resembled their profile. And it just goes into how they're being dehumanized by it, and how they're not having relationships, and how they're not living, and how they're getting fat. And I get it. We're already indoors working too much. We already got too many bills to pay online. All that. You need to get out. And I know I'm saying things that's already known. Climb a hill. Climb a mountain. Go for a mile swim. Don't know how to swim a mile? Swim 200 yards. Before you know it, you'll be swimming a mile. I'm going to go swim a mile today. Maybe more. I might go for 2 miles. And just live. And that's what builds your mental muscles. Travel. Experience things. Go volunteer for charity. Go join a boxing club. Go take airplane flying lessons. They're not that expensive. Just do something. Live. You're only alive once. That's the answer. Break out of the matrix and only use the digital system to jack in to warn others. We'll be back with a story of Hercules. Don't forget, tonight, the nightly news are going to be focusing in big time at 7 o'clock Central on these current developments. China currency shock, yuan value slashed, oil tumbles, stocks spooked. That's developing tonight, 7 o'clock Central. That'll be our top story. We'll know more after the stock market closes. 7 o'clock tonight, PrisonPlanet.tv. Okay. Speaking of the nightly news tonight, we will have actually the HD video that Rob Dew shot to go along with the report I'm about to verbally give you. Earlier in the broadcast, I talked about the Garth Brooks song where he talks about sometimes God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. And I think back in my life how many times I wanted something, how many times I prayed about something, and what I wanted in my heart didn't happen, and it turned out that it was a great thing that it didn't happen. Because when one door shuts, a lot of other doors open. And sure, all these things I'm saying are cliches because they're so true. So I traveled to Rome, was there 5 days with our reporters to research just how bad the immigrant waves into the country are, just how serious the infrastructure problems are, and to see just how draconian EU tyranny was. And we're making a documentary on that subject. We also went to Spain. But when you talk about sometimes God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers, I don't literally think this story is true. That is, I don't think Zeus was real or that the archetype of Hercules was real. But it is a good parallel to understand how the real world works, that when one door closes, another opens. Now, this part of the story is true. There was a pantheon of Hercules and his 99 statues of each of them at the Temple to Hercules. And in Roman times, the huge bronze statue of Hercules, I stood below it, it's got to be about 40 feet tall, was struck by lightning during a storm and knocked over. The Romans thought this was an omen, a sign. They were obsessed with tea leaves and reading the entrails of animals and the stars, that the king of the gods, Zeus, was angry with Hercules and had hit him with this bolt of lightning because Zeus is the god of lightning. And, of course, that's the name of the Greek god of lightning, the king of the gods. It's the same god under the Romans but called Jupiter. So Jupiter was angry and had killed Hercules in figure because they believed the statues were actually inhabited by the spirit of the god, or at least an aspect of the god. They have the temple to Mars there across the street from the Roman Forum, but it's Mars Vengeance, built by the adopted son of Julius Caesar I. After he pledged to wipe out all those that killed his father, when the last one was killed, he built this temple. But I digress. Then, hundreds of years later, when barbarians from the north, Visigoths, came in and sacked Rome and melted down the bronze statues into weapons, the only statue they couldn't find was Hercules, because they believed Hercules had been basically killed by Zeus, and so the Romans had buried him under the temple floor right where he'd fallen. So all the other 99 of Hercules were melted down, and their physical embodiment was destroyed. So was it a curse from Jupiter? Was it a curse from Zeus in the Greek to strike him with lightning and knock him down, knowing the Romans would then bury him, and then a few hundred years later he wouldn't be destroyed? Or was it a blessing so that he now stands in the center of the Vatican Museum surrounded by all this other incredible art? That is an allegory or a parable of sometimes curses are actually blessings and blessings are actually curses. You've just got to have the perspective and time and realize that sometimes Jupiter works in mysterious ways. And before the New York Times runs with a story saying I believe in Greek and Roman gods, I don't. But I believe in the aspects of those gods as archetypes, we can certainly learn from it. And I think the Romans had a lot more common sense than a lot of our leaders today. And I was drawn to the Roman art. I was repulsed by the Vatican art. And the Vatican itself at St. Peter's Basilica looked like a nightmare giant Las Vegas casino on steroids. And one of the worst vibes I've ever felt. Worse vibe than even the Roman Colosseum. That's just my gut response. Maybe it's because Pope Francis, the world government globalist, is now in control, or maybe it always felt like that. That's it for this transmission. Great job of the crew and our reporters on the ground in Missouri. Lord willing, I'll join you here.